The first item on the order paper is a motion on the United Kingdom withdrawal from the European Union. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 3 hours for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly notes the result of the referendum on European Union membership and calls on the Executive to set out, in the immediate future, its response to the consequences of the withdrawal of the United Kingdom from the European Union.
I call Mr. Mike Nesbitt to move the motion.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much, and I thank you for allowing the motion. I do believe it is right that the first order of business for this chamber since the referendum should be to discuss the implications and the consequences of what happened at the tail end of last week. I note that Sam McBride in the newsletter lent on the words of W.B. Yeats to sum it up. Everything has changed, utterly changed. Mr. Speaker, I'm not sure if that's right, because I believe what has actually happened is we have entered an era of uncertainty, an uncertainty that will last years, not months. There is only one certainty, Mr. Speaker, and that is the result, and the result is the result. Be in no doubt, we ask the people of the United Kingdom for their view, and the people of the United Kingdom gave us their view, and it was to leave the European Union. And the Ulster Unionist Party accepts that result. The result is the result, and there is no point trying to say it is a non-binding referendum and that Parliament is sovereign. Given the low esteem many of us as elected politicians here and in other chambers are held in by the people of the United Kingdom, that's the last thing we should do, to say, well, tell us what you want us to do and then let us ignore it and do what we want to do. No, the result is the result. We are on our way out of the European Union. We have to accept that, but I believe, Mr. Speaker, we should also acknowledge that within Northern Ireland, 56% of the people who voted to remain in the United Kingdom. Just acknowledge that. And the first question to the First Ministers is how they factor that in to how they deal with the consequences of the referendum. David, I may give way later on, but I have a lot of progress to make. David Cameron, as the Prime Minister of all the people of the United Kingdom, asked for a Remain vote, did not get it, and has indicated his intention to resign. Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister of all the people of Scotland, asked for a Remain vote within Scotland, got it, and therefore has a clear mandate to take to the negotiations that will involve the UK government and the devolved institutions. Arlene Foster, as First Minister of Northern Ireland, asked for a Brexit vote and did not get it within Northern Ireland. So there's a question there, I believe, Mr. Speaker, a legitimate question to ask of the First Minister. I said I may give way later on. A legitimate question to ask of the First Minister when she goes into those negotiations, how she balances her party political view for Brexit against the fact that 56% of the people who voted within Northern Ireland said, let us remain within the European Union. And I look forward to the First Minister's response to that. But this is not about going over the result. The result is the result, Mr. Speaker. It is about the implications and the consequences of the result for the people of Northern Ireland. And there are huge consequences and perhaps some unintended ones. And the first consequence for us is that we look to London and recognise the fact that of the two parties who are capable of governing for Downing Street, neither has a leader with credibility anymore, because the Prime Minister, Mr. Cameron, as I say, has indicated his intention to stand down. And I believe this morning the Deputy Leader of the Labour Party, Tom Watson, went to his leader, Jeremy Corbyn, and told him to stand down as leader of the Labour Party. And so we find ourselves with a certain political crisis. I'll give way to the member.
Thank you for giving way. Maybe you could tell us actually whenever you're going to remove the whip from Tom Elliott.
The member misunderstands the position of the Ulster Unionist Party, which I will come to during the course. Mr. Speaker, I was hoping that after such a divisive campaign, and with the eyes of Northern Ireland, perhaps of the world, on this chamber this morning, that we would have a respectful, a thoughtful and a respectful debate. And I hope we can still do that, because I will not give way. So what are the implications and the consequences? Well, let's start with the finances, because nobody, I think, was in any doubt that Northern Ireland currently and for some time has been a net beneficiary of European funding. It's not just for agriculture, for our voluntary and community sector, for our university. No, I will not give way. Mr. Speaker, I would ask you, Mr. Speaker, I would ask you to reflect.
Can I ask the member to take a seat? This is obviously going to be a debate with a fair amount of emotion from all sides of the House. I would ask the members to be respectful to each other. That includes how they address each other. That includes the titles they apply to each other, members. So I would ask, when it's quite clear that a member is not going to give an intervention, that that is respected by the person, the member seeking the intervention. Mr. Nesbitt.
Mr. Speaker, I'd ask you to reflect on the comments from Mr. Allister, who I believe accused me of peddling falsehoods. I would ask you to reflect on that and come back to us when you are ready. So it's not just about the peace funds, and we all agree we've done well from peace funds, but it's about the competitive drawdown. It's about the common agricultural policy, the single farm payment. It's about our universities, our community and voluntary sector. It's about our infrastructure, and we all agree that to have a vibrant economy, we need to invest in our infrastructure. I believe I saw our Minister, Chris Hazard, out in Brussels a few days ago discussing 10T, something we did very well with, when my colleague Danny Kennedy was the Minister for Regional Development. In the last programme for government, for the first time, we had a target for competitive drawdown of European funds, and we matched it easily. And I would have hoped we were going to be much more competitive, much more ambitious in the next programme for government. But can we even compete for infrastructure funds? Why would the European Union, over the remaining years, when the withdrawal is negotiated, why would they give us money for infrastructure, for projects that are going to be of benefit to the United Kingdom for the next 5, 10, 15 or 20 years? And what about corporation tax? The big idea, Mr. Speaker. What happens now to corporation tax? Is there an opportunity here to get it without a hit to the block grant? Or has it gone? Has it gone for good? This is the sort of clarity that we seek from our First Ministers. The LCA's position has been very clear.
Point of order, Mr. Stalford.
Mr. Speaker, in a previous statement from the Chair, you advised all members that they should at all times refer to other members by their correct and proper title. Would you judge, Mr. Speaker, that it's out with that recommendation for the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party to be using the term the First Ministers? There is a First Minister and a Deputy First Minister.
I've already addressed that point. Thank you. I have already addressed the point of referring to people by their correct title.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. So the LCA's position was that, on balance, Northern Ireland was better off within the European Union. Not the United Kingdom, but Northern Ireland was better off on balance within the European Union, with the UK government arguing for further reform, back to free trade and away from political union. And that is still our position. And, Mr. Speaker, on the money, when we discussed it as an executive, I took my pen and I said to anybody in the room, if you are prepared to take this pen and write a blank cheque that guarantees Northern Ireland will not be one penny worse off in the event of a Brexit, then I will vote for Brexit. Nobody took that pen, Mr. Speaker. And now I ask whether the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister will take that pen and guarantee our agriculture sector, our universities, our voluntary and community sector, and everybody else who benefits from European Union money, they will not be a penny worse off. I will leave the pen there for a blank cheque to be signed. And what about the Barnett formula? What is the next? I am not giving way, Mr. Speaker. I've made the point now. What about the Barnett formula? We know some of the Brexiteers, like Lord Owen, have made the point that the Barnett formula should go. What are the implications for Northern Ireland? And then there's the border. Were we misinformed about the border, the common travel area? I notice the Taoiseach has said he will do his best to maintain the common travel arrangements. Not that he guarantees they will stay, but he will do his best. What is the plan within the Executive Office with regard to the border, with regard to immigration, and what about the future of the United Kingdom, Mr. Speaker? I heard members of this House say there is no way Scotland will press for another vote on independence. I heard members of this House say it won't happen because the price of oil has plummeted and they can't afford it. And I said, I do not want my fingerprints on the button that Nicola Sturgeon will press to secure a second referendum. And my fingerprints are not on that button, but the fingerprints of the Leader of the DUP are on that button, and she is going to press it. And what is the future for Northern Ireland? As nationalism reacts with anger to the fact that those out with this part of the United Kingdom have voted for a Brexit. I love the United Kingdom. I remain convinced that we are all better off in Northern Ireland as part of the United Kingdom, and I want an assurance from the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister that they will work tirelessly to persuade the people that we are still better off within the United Kingdom, even in the event of this Brexit. There is a lot to answer, and the final question, Mr. Speaker, to the First Minister and Deputy First Minister is, why is there no contingency plan to deal with this calamity?
Call Mr. Christopher Stalford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, sir. Mr. Speaker, what happened over the course of the weekend was an exercise in democracy. The people of the United Kingdom, from every corner of the United Kingdom, were, for the first time in 40 years, given their chance to have their say upon the continuation of our country's membership of the European Union. And I think it's fair to look at the opposing sides in this campaign. On the one side was Goldman Sachs, big business, the EU, the IMF, the political establishment of this country. They were convinced it was in the bag, convinced that the case for staying in the European Union was so self-evident that no person could ever dare to vote against it. Well, Mr. Speaker, they got their answer on Friday morning. Ordinary people, the ordinary people of this country, who for years have been sneered at and ignored by the political and media establishment in this country, their values held in contempt, simple things like love of country held up as foolishness, they had their say. I knew in my own constituency that it would be an uphill climb, and I said that if we got above 28% for leave, I would be pleased. In the end, we got 30.5%. And I knew when I seen record high turnouts in places like Donegal Pass, Sandy Row, the Donegal Road, the Woodstock Road, even where I live in the Braniel, ordinary people who don't come out and vote at election time were fired up to come out and vote in this referendum because they were fed up with being ignored by the media and political elite, fed up with being treated with contempt. I have heard since this result was announced some of the worst denigration of our older population. I think it is disgraceful to hear people saying older people shouldn't have the vote. Older people have betrayed the future of the young. It's because of the effort of the older people of this country that they have a future to look forward to. To treat them with such contempt is disgraceful. I enjoyed the campaign. The Leave campaign in Northern Ireland was a cross-section of people. No. Was a cross-section, I'll give way later, was a cross-section of people drawn from my own party, the TUV, UKIP, and I'm delighted to say a good many Ulster Unionist members were out with us making the case for leaving the European Union. We have heard that this is a time for seriousness. We have heard that this is a time for seriousness. Well, seriousness requires that we have discussion in the chamber and we have reasoned argument. We don't run off to the Irish news saying the union is under threat because we were on the losing side of the referendum, as some have chosen to do. The reality is that the people of this country were offered a choice, and they made their choice. And I say to those who were on the opposing side, had the vote went the other way, I would have had to take it on the chin and move on. I know what it's like personally to lose an election, and I know what it's like to be on the losing side of a referendum. And I say to those who just assumed that the people would do what they were told, that they should accept the verdict of the people. Over the last 48 hours, we have heard all sorts of crazy and interesting ideas as to how the people's verdict can be overturned. We have a Labour MP saying that Parliament should simply ignore it because it was only an advisory and non-binding referendum outcome. And I've no doubt we'll hear some of that today. I say to go down that road and to ignore the democratic verdict of the people of this United Kingdom would be a grave mistake.
Call Mr. Conor Murphy.
Very pleased to get the chance to speak in this debate. I suppose there quite clearly already is quite a lot of political difference in relation to the issues that were debated and the outcome of the referendum. But I think the one thing that should and can unify us is that we are left with an impending mess as a consequence of the vote that was taken last Thursday. And it is the responsibility of all of us to try and navigate our way out of that mess that we find ourselves in. And whether someone accepts the results of the referendum or not, had the referendum voted to remain in Europe, we would not be faced with the huge degree of uncertainty and potential difficulty that we now face. And so that is something that, regardless of people wanting to leave or to stay, we are now presented with a very serious political, economic and social difficulty that we have to chart our way through. There is no clarity from those who led the Leave campaign, or indeed from the British government, as to how we will navigate our way through this political upheaval. And at a local level, and I was involved in the campaign in my own constituency, the constituents are angry and bewildered, their future and their children's future will be decided not by themselves, but by people living on a neighbouring island. And that democratic deficit and that lack of self-determination is clearly another story which we will return to. My own area, Newry and Dundalk, were two busy ports, market towns located centrally in the east coast of Ireland with a shared hinterland pre-partition. And their economic potential was sundered by partition and surrendered really for the best part of 70 years. It was only with the advent of the single market and with specific European funds designed to remove the hard border, to deal with the negative impact of partition, funds like Interreg, Peace, European Social Fund, some of the rural development programmes, that communities in that border area began to recover, began to look forward with some optimism to a better economic future for them, having been on the periphery of two states for so long. And they are now fearful and somewhat bewildered as for their future. So we have a responsibility, I think, collectively, regardless of what our position was in the referendum, regardless of how we see the outcome of that, we have a responsibility collectively, in the absence of any sense of direction from London, is to chart the best course for the people that we represent, to give clarity and some direction. And that involves not just simply the executive. Obviously, the executive have a very key role in relation to that, and I look forward to hearing from the First Minister later on, and no doubt from other ministers as the days and weeks progress. But it also involves the opposition, it involves all of us collectively, because we have a collective responsibility in this institution. And people are looking, in the absence of any sense of clarity and direction elsewhere, people certainly of this six counties and across Ireland are looking for some direction here, and indeed some direction in Dublin. We do have, I think, also a responsibility to engage with the Irish government in relation to this. They are obviously going to be key players in terms of negotiating in future for matters in this island in relation to Europe. And this decision undoubtedly has a very negative economic impact on them also. And I think we do have to, given the nature of our institutional arrangements, have to ensure that we have a close working relationship with the Irish Government, and indeed with Scotland, who find themselves in the same position that we're in, having decided in their jurisdiction that they wish to remain, and now find themselves against their wishes to be out of the European Union in the near future. And I think we specifically have a responsibility to engage with the sectors who would be most concerned, the business sectors, the community and voluntary sectors, farming and trade unions, and other people across society who were heavily reliant on the European Union and some of the funds that it provided in terms of their own business. Our vote to remain, the clear majority that was given here in the six counties, I think does give us a strong hand in terms of the negotiations that lie ahead, that the British Government will be involved in, that we need to be involved in, that the Irish Government need to be involved in, because we have specifically expressed our own wishes in relation to this, and I think that does give us a strong hand in terms of the British Government attempting to ride roughshod over the impacts of this on the people that we represent. So we do need a common purpose. Let's have the debates. People can argue the toss in relation to which side they were on and the outcome of that. But when the dust settles on this, we do need a common purpose, and we need to row in behind our executive and collectively with all of the political parties here, with our friends south of the border, with friends in Scotland, and particularly with friends in Europe, to try and make the best possible outcome of this for the people that we represent.
Call Mr. Colm Eastwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I hope that some of the comments that we've heard from sedentary positions isn't going to be how this debate develops. And I don't just mean in here, because I think what everybody in here who calls himself a Democrat should recognise is that people here in the north of Ireland voted for our position within the European Union to remain the same. People in Scotland did that as well. Young people everywhere formed a coalition to have a positive relationship with the European Union. And people here in particular in Northern Ireland understand the benefits that this place has given us. The number of people I spoke to on Friday in my own constituency, that's surrounded on three sides by a border, the number of people that I spoke to in that constituency who were devastated, who were scared, who were extremely worried about what comes next. And when you see posters all around, I have to drive past a whole load of them coming here in the morning. When you see posters all around Northern Ireland telling you it's going to be £350 million more for the health service and all that sort of stuff. And of course, the Leave side are now rowing back on those great big commitments about the health service, about immigration, about all those plans that they made to...
Thank the member for giving way. Is the Remain side rowing back in the Third World War?
Well, first of all, I don't know what you're talking about, but I made a commitment to speak positively about the European Union throughout that campaign, and I think we did, because we know the benefits of it. But now the Leave campaign is rowing back on all their big claims, and we told them the whole way throughout that campaign that that was going to happen, because the notion that you're going to be able to have access to the single market whilst at the same time controlling immigration is utter nonsense. It is nonsense, and it's proven to be nonsense in places like Norway and Switzerland. So there was a whole lot of lies told, Mr. Speaker, but people here, people in Northern Ireland still saw through it and were standing as Democrats by the people here who decided that we're not being dragged out of the European Union by the right wing of the Tory party or anybody else who doesn't want to listen to the benefits of the European Union. Yeah.
He says he's not going to be dragged out of the European Union. I don't know what the question was in the ballot paper he used, but in the ballot paper I used, the question was very clear. Do I want the United Kingdom to leave or to stay? The question was never, do you want Northern Ireland to stay? And the only autonomous answer is the answer that came from the entirety of the people of the United Kingdom. Is he going to accept that, or is he not?
Well, no is the answer, because I stand by people. Because I stand by people on this island. You see?
gracious and victory as usual. I stand by people on this island, in this country, who don't want to leave the European Union. And one minute we're told that Northern Ireland's a nation and then the UK is a nation. I'm not sure what people are actually trying to tell us, but people in Northern Ireland told us that, no, I've given away enough. People in Northern Ireland told us that they wanted to remain within the European Union. And we're going to look for every single device possible to make sure that happens, and I hope others join with us. I know all about democracy, and some people in here need to learn about democracy, because I remember a referendum that was held on this island not all that long ago, where people voted for the Good Friday Agreement. And the member who's shouting from his seat, and some of the members across who were shouting from their seats earlier, didn't recognise that the people of this island voted for the Good Friday Agreement. And what did that Good Friday Agreement mean? It meant that people from my persuasion who want to see a united Ireland were able to democratically argue for and democratically work towards that goal. We all accepted that the principle of consent was key to that. Well, let me tell you, Mr. Speaker, the people of the north of Ireland are not giving their consent to be dragged out of the European Union, and we stand by them on that. And let me just deal with the point that the Secretary of State made about the principle of consent and about the Good Friday Agreement. Whilst I don't think this is the right time for a border poll, because I believe we should have a border poll that we can actually win, and our duty today, do you not want to hear it? No. Our duty today, Mr. Speaker, is to deal with the issues it faces right now. But the Secretary of State has got it wrong when she says that just because people on the nationalist side are saying that they agree with the principle of consent and that they agree with the Good Friday Agreement doesn't mean that they give consent to our position within the United Kingdom. And we will continue to democratically work towards changing that. Right now, we're not about to be dragged out against our will of the European Union. And I think the interest, I would love to hear the DUP explain to me today how you're going to enforce a border on this island, how you're going to control the freedom of movement of people into the British Isles. How are you going to do that? Because I don't think you can. So I think you've voted for something that you haven't really thought through. And I think someday, when you look at what's happening in Scotland, when you look at what's happening here, people are beginning to see that the next step is further integration across this island, working together with our unionist neighbours to begin the process of working within the European context for delivering for our people here, not to be dragged out against our will by Sunderland or Surrey or anywhere else.
Can I ask that members are listened to with respect and that they are allowed to make their arguments across the chamber? Can I also ask that members, when speaking, address all their remarks through the chair? I call Ms. Naomi Long.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. At the outset of my remarks, I think we do need to acknowledge that the vote across the UK was to leave the European Union. For me, that is a regrettable decision, but I acknowledge and I accept that decision. That means that the UK will now begin a process of negotiation that will fundamentally change not just our relationship with the EU, but the EU itself, and potentially our relationships within the United Kingdom. To do otherwise, we'd leave an electorate which was already clearly angry and disaffected, more angry and disaffected. It is true that Parliament have primacy on these matters. It is also true that referendums are merely advisory. However, no government should ever go to the people and ask their view on a matter simply to ignore the view that they are given by the people. That does not mean that in future, when these new arrangements are made, when the new arrangements are in place, that it would not be equally as appropriate for any government then to ask the people whether or not they are happy with those new arrangements. But as we stand today, that is where we are. We have to, though, acknowledge, and the Leave campaign need to acknowledge, the sharp divide that has opened up between England and Wales and Scotland and Northern Ireland on this issue. There has to be some reflection of the clear desire, the clearly expressed wish of the people of Scotland and the people of Northern Ireland to remain at the heart of the European Union. That must be reflected in any arrangements which are negotiated by the government for the future. To ignore that, to fail to seek an accommodation of those views is, I believe, to place the future of the United Kingdom in peril. And I am surprised at the rather blasé approach that some unionists are taking to that risk, given that they are those who are most invested in retaining the United Kingdom. I also, Mr. Speaker, have no intentions, I will not give way, I also have no intentions, Mr. Speaker, of taking lectures from the party opposite on how to accept losing or indeed winning elections and votes with any measure of good grace. Whether it is the Good Friday Agreement, a democratic decision on flags on City Hall, or many others that would take too long to list, that party does not have a good record when it comes to good grace in democratic decision making. However, I don't want to reopen today a referendum debate. We have, in the context of a very close result, a very divisive result, have to look at how we now provide the sort of leadership which will get us to a place of stability, because the continuing instability is a threat to our economy, to social cohesion in this society, and to our future as a regional economy in Europe, whilst clearly and potentially no longer within the EU. Each of the constituent nations of the United Kingdom now have special arrangements and relationships with the Westminster Parliament, and the EU itself will be irrevocably changed by the departure of the UK. In that context, everything is open for discussion, and therefore acknowledging in any agreements that are made the clear votes to remain within the EU from Scotland and Northern Ireland is not beyond the capacity of a strong and coherent negotiating team. And my question to the First Minister and Deputy First Minister is clear. Can they provide that coherent negotiating team on behalf of Northern Ireland, given the fact that the majority of people here wish to remain, whilst it may be the position of the First Minister's own party that she wishes to leave? And there is a genuine question in that, that I place before them and ask them to consider today. We have a need, I think, to reassure business, to reassure people in Northern Ireland about the future and to maximise certainty. That reassurance is not coming from Westminster, which has now dissolved into the kind of chaos that we were told was scaremongering, but is now the news. So I would ask that we see strong leadership in Northern Ireland, but more than just for business, more than just for the people of Northern Ireland. For those EU members, I will give way.
Well, to the member for giving way, I don't seem to recall at any point during the referendum campaign those arguing for Remain telling us that we should stay in for fear that David Cameron might resign or Jeremy Corbyn would be subject to a coup. When you reference the trouble at Westminster, those are entirely internal party political matters for the Tories and Labour.
Well, the member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Let's be honest. The referendum itself was entirely an internal party political matter for the Conservative Party. So, I mean, we all knew that when we voted, and we knew that that was what it was about, Mr. Speaker. And those who argued that it was about any higher principle, frankly, need their heads examined. Now, if we're going to be honest about this, the reassurance that I want to seek today is for those EU nationals, and indeed other migrants, who live in our communities, who work in our communities, and who make a contribution to this society, because they feel vulnerable and afraid after this vote. And I want reassurance for them that they are still welcome, that we are still an open and tolerant democracy, and that they have a place in our future. Thank you.
Call Mr. Edwin Poots.
Mr. Speaker, I find it kind of ironic that the proposer of this motion today is none other than Mr. Nesbitt, particularly after reading today's newspaper and his comments about people considering their positions. Mr. Cameron called a referendum, and Mr. Cameron lost that referendum in spite of throwing everything, including the kitchen sink of Downing Street, at it, with many inaccurate and untrue statements which the public chose to ignore, and I believe wisely chose to ignore. By Mr. Nesbitt's logic, Carwin Jones should also resign. He didn't happen to mention that this morning. And indeed, in his own Strangford constituency, 5,000 people more voted to leave than to remain so as by his own logic he's lost his own constituency and he should resign. But we go back to the principle of the standing of our First Minister. Our First Minister went to the country just over a month ago and came back with a vote of some 207,000, an increased mandate. And Mr Nesbitt went to the country and he came back with 87,000 votes, which was a decreased mandate. Mr Nesbitt managed to take the leadership of the Ulster Unionist Party when it was at rock bottom and then take it down further. Mr Nesbitt has been grovelling about...
Can I ask the member to come back to the motion?
Well, it is to do with certainly the challenge from Mr Nesbitt in terms of the First Minister, but nonetheless, he's been grovelling about on the dust on his stomach and now he wants to spit it out at us this morning, having failed and failed so miserably. People voted for a reason not to stay in Europe. Indeed, most of the former leaders of the Ulster Unionist Party voted not to stay in the European Union, including the immediate past leader, Tom Elliott, and David Trimble. So Mr Nesbitt does not command the support of his own party. Yes, sir.
Can the member confirm that he is now completely reconciled to Lord Trimble?
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you for giving me the extra minute, and I'll give way again if you let us know how you voted yourself, Mr Kennedy.
But what the member give way?
Yes.
I thank the member for giving way. Does it worry the member, and in fact should it not worry the rest of his party as well, that Mike Nesbitt seems to be suggesting that because there's the threat of a Scottish independence referendum for the second time, that unionism should act in a different way? Surely that is nationalism dictating to unionism. And doesn't that show that the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party is better suited to the role of a commentator than to the role of leader?
Well, it's for the people to decide on what role he has. I think the people decided very convincingly at the Assembly election, but he decided to cling on to his position and become Leader of Opposition as a result. But in terms of this, ironically, all of these people are saying you'll break up the Union if you vote to leave, but the Nationalists in Scotland, the Nationalists in Wales and the Nationalists in Northern Ireland all want you to vote to remain. And the Unionists who joined them, of course, as the Ulster Unionists, they joined all of the Nationalists, indeed Republicans, to say vote remain, whenever clearly the people voted something different. In Northern Ireland, DUP lifted 207,000 votes at the Assembly election. 350,000 people voted to leave the European Union. Quite clearly, many, many Ulster Unionists walked away from the guidance and the leadership of Mr Nesbitt to back the leadership of the DUP. And if any leader is considering their position this morning in this chamber, it is the leader of the Ulster Unionist Party who has been exposed and found wanting, because he has failed and failed miserably, both in the Assembly election, and he has failed to provide good, solid leadership to the people of the Ulster Unionist Party over the course of this particular election. The one thing that I find deep... Yes, I'll give way.
Ask in the little time he's left, can the member maybe take some time to address the concerns of people in my constituency and border constituencies and every other constituency across Northern Ireland today? Because all I'm hearing is an internal unionist argument.
Fair enough, you are hearing an internal unionist argument, and I'll complete that before I touch yours just at this moment in time. We are a one-nation united kingdom, and that one nation has made a decision, and it is for Parliament, our sovereign Parliament at Westminster, to enact the will, the democratically expressed will of the people of this United Kingdom. And if we split Northern Ireland, we split Scotland, as some people want to suggest, are we going to split Northern Ireland as well? Because many constituencies in Northern Ireland voted to leave, and that's very evident. This nation will be staying together, and Nicola Sturgeon will fail in what she's doing. In terms of the border issues, all of these things need to be discussed. We will work very closely with the Republic of Ireland government in ensuring there is as little change as possible as a result of this decision, and ensure that people
will be able to enjoy all of the benefits. We need to divest ourselves of the regulations that Europe has imposed upon us. This gives business, farmers and many, many people great opportunities to move forward, deal with the rest of the world and take this challenge on in a very positive way.
No, whatever else the United Kingdom is, it's not united, either in terms of its desires around the futures of the nations which make up that current United Kingdom, whether it's around socio-economic policies, race policies or anything else. And the recent debate in Britain around the referendum has shown the rifts within the society there and here. So the term united doesn't fit this debate. Now, I know members opposite and members to at my side here are using the term traditionally as we refer to the United Kingdom, but let's not anyone in this chamber believe that there's any unity of purpose as a result of the referendum decision made last week. No matter how you look at these group of islands, they are divided like they've never been divided before. And the EU referendum result is the biggest single social and economic shock to hit the island of Ireland since partition. And we have to recognise that, regardless of where your allegiances lie, whether they lie with the Union or they lie, as mine do, my party colleagues do, with the reunification of Ireland. And we have to deal with it. And the motion itself refers to calling on the executive in the immediate future. Its response to the consequences of the withdrawal of the United Kingdom from the European Union. Now, I have to say, the executive hands are somewhat tied on this, because the executive will not be able to work out a response until the Conservative Party sorts out its internal squabbles, appoints a leader, appoints a Prime Minister, and quite likely has to appoint a Chancellor of the Exchequer in the very near future. So the executive, the First and Deputy First Minister, are somewhat constrained in what they can do, but I have no doubt, despite their differences on this issue and numerous other issues, the First and Deputy First Minister will work and do their very best for this society. They will do their very best for this economy. They will do their very best for the people who they represent here in the North. And as my colleague Mr Murphy said, there's also a responsibility on the opposition to work in tandem and to work positively to ensure that outcome will give way.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. I'm interested in the member telling us that the First and Deputy First Minister will work together in this. Is the reality not that they are as disunited on this subject as the Kingdom is today on the whole issue in a disunited Kingdom?
I don't think it's going to cause news flashes around the world that Martin McGuinness is an Irish Republican and Arlene Foster is a Unionist. And they're disunited on that, but they have shown they can put their differences aside and they can work for the betterment of society, not as well as required now. It is required leadership, if I can in one moment. What is required now is leadership on this issue. But returning to the referendum and the uncertainties which the referendum has thrown up to us, there's always certainty in uncertainty. And now we can be certain that the £350 million a week which was promised to the health service actually is not going to the health service. We can be certain that emigration, which those who are opposed to EU membership, emigration and immigration will continue. We won't be able to stop immigration. As part of their negotiations, which will have to take place with the European Union, if they want to trade into the European Union, they will have to do likewise, which other nations in the European continent are doing. And free movement of people is part of that. Why is a free movement of people part of that? Because despite the fears which were promoted by some in the Leave campaign, immigration is actually good for the economy. It is actually good for the economy. And I want to turn to our brothers and sisters from the European states who are already living here, from those from other ethnic minorities, and I would hope send out a very, very unified message from this Assembly that their contribution to our economy is welcomed, their continued contribution to our economy is absolutely necessary, and we as an Assembly We as an executive, we as political leaders, defend their right to be here, and we welcome them here with open arms. In conclusion, the time ahead is going to be very difficult because the principle of trickle-down economics, which many in this House, and I would be one of them, would argue doesn't work in the method it should work and doesn't deliver for those at the bottom of the stream, works in a quite different way. The losses which we're seeing on the stock markets across the globe on Friday will have a trickle-down impact. And who's going to pay for those losses? It isn't going to be big business, because we learnt that from the last recession. It isn't going to be any of the big businesses, whichever side of the argument they were on last week. It is going to be the ordinary person on the street is going to pay for those big losses on the stock market last week. And our budget and our economy is going to be impacted on that. And that's why it's vitally important. I'm confident that the First and Deputy First Minister are going to work together. I hope I can be confident that the opposition will work with them. Thank you very much.
Call Emma Little-Pengelly.
Mr. Speaker, I welcome the vote of the people of the United Kingdom to leave the European Union project. Over the last number of days, and including today in this chamber, I have listened to and read of the hysteria of those in the Remain camp. Firstly, let me be clear. We all knew the terms of this referendum. We voted individually as a citizen of the United Kingdom on the position of the United Kingdom. Those were the terms accepted by all sides, including the Remain. It is fundamentally dishonest for some in the Remain camp to attempt to change the parameters retrospectively when the result didn't go their way. Secondly, Mr. Speaker, it is offensive and unacceptable that there are those in the Remain camp, particularly the elected reps in Northern Ireland, who try to portray those Leave voters as racist, stupid, uninformed or misinformed or uneducated. This is an issue of respect about the outcome. We have heard already here today a patronising view towards those who voted Leave. They may not be the commentators, the journalists, the establishment or the left-wing liberals who dominate the public narrative, but there's a clear message. The so-called little people have spoken. The oft-silent majority across the United Kingdom have made their feelings clear. The mouse has roared and become the lion. And millions of decent and upstanding people have all of the lefty liberals in a spin. The reality is Europe had become too detached, too unaccountable. Yet within this context, there was an ever-growing agenda of increased scope and remit. There is an irony about the position of Mike Nesbitt in relation to this, criticising others when not only does he not represent the view of unionism in Northern Ireland, but we all suspect he doesn't even represent the views of the Ulster Unionist Party on this issue. I know my party leader and the First Minister of this country will fight her hardest for the best deal for Northern Ireland, the best deal for the farmers, the best deal for the economy, and the best deal for our public services and all in Northern Ireland.
Mr. Speaker, thank you very much indeed for those comments, and I apologise for coming into this debate late. One of the questions I would have to do is that many representatives of unionism and many of my constituents who did indeed vote for Remain, they have decided and they have been communicating with me how much they were concerned with what's been going on. So it's not just a question of unionism as well.
I'll ask the member to come to a question.
The member
has an extra minute.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I am standing here today to give assurances to the people of Northern Ireland. I know other speakers will do so as well. Assurances that the First Minister will fight for the best deal for Northern Ireland in relation to the renegotiations. I know that she will roll up her sleeves and fight fiercely for all in Northern Ireland, including those who have decided to vote Remain, and for those who decided to vote Leave. And I want people to be reassured of that today. This is a new dawn for the United Kingdom. There is, of course, much work to be done, much negotiation, but also much opportunity. Today, I stand here still as a European. You know, people need not to listen to the hysteria, but to buckle down and look at the opportunities that this provides for us. We are standing here today free to negotiate and build a new and recalibrated relationship on the world stage, including with the European Union, a better deal for an independent and sovereign United Kingdom on the world stage. Our message today is one of hope, not despair. People need to keep calm. People need to listen to what is being said. Do not listen to the hysteria. We should not fear change, but should embrace the opportunities that will come from removing from our wrists the shackles of this failed European Union project.
Call Mr. Philip Smith.
Mr. Speaker, our economic and political environment fundamentally changed with last week's referendum result. The Bank has put in place extensive contingency plans, so said Mark Carney, Governor of the Bank of England, on Friday, to try and calm the market freefall in the pound. We're well prepared for this, continued Mr. Carney, who showed a steady hand and provided reassurance to the markets. Mr. Speaker, the question is, are we similarly well prepared? I would hope we are, but fear that comments from the Deputy First Minister suggest otherwise. When asked what our contingency plans are, he clearly said there isn't one. His only contribution was to add more uncertainty with a proposal for an unnecessary and unwinnable border poll. As we move into a period of economic turbulence and political uncertainty, it is foolhardy in the extreme to seek to add further instability, especially when, as officials recently told the Finance Committee, that Northern Ireland's deficit with the Treasury is currently £9.2 billion, making any prospect of Irish unity an economic non-starter. The bottom line is that a UK-wide referendum vote was taken, a decision was made, and we now need to move forward as a United Kingdom, not component parts, to obtain the best deal for our country. The First Minister said on Friday also that we need a period of calm, stability and leadership, but also stated that there is no contingency plan. Surely this is a bizarre situation when the First Minister hasn't planned for the outcome that she campaigned for, especially when the result was going to be close and uncertain. Where is the Northern Ireland Executive's contingency plan? We are all aware that we have received billions from the EU in recent years, and there are also billions still to come during the next budget phase until 2020. £1.2 billion in cap payments in rural development, a further billion from the current round of regional development funds, and millions more from social fund and peace monies. Some of the funding may well be covered by additional budget from Westminster, some may not. At this stage, no one knows. The expectation is that it will be 2 years at least before the full ramifications become clear. But again, no one knows. What we do know is that we will be impacted by two issues, both outside our control. Firstly, a significantly weaker pound will reduce the value of EU payments, both in the short term to us, the executive, and funding recipients like our farmers. There's an element of swings and roundabouts, of course, but the net impact is likely to dampen growth and investment in the short term, thereby reducing the revenue generated by Northern Ireland. Estimates of this impact of the EU exit on Northern Ireland suggest a 3% reduction in GDP. Second, we must also look at our debt and the potential for increased costs to fund that debt. Let us also bear in mind that this executive is indebted to the tune of over £1,200 per person, compared to, for example, £530 per capita in Scotland. On Saturday, Moody's downgraded the UK's long-term issuer and debt ratings to negative from stable. Their analysis is that, and I quote, "the negative effect from lower economic growth will outweigh the fiscal savings from the UK no longer having to contribute to the EU budget." This reduced credit rating will result in higher borrowing costs for government, businesses and households in the longer term. Mr. Speaker, we have a challenging financial environment exacerbated by the failure of the previous executive to mend the roof while the sun shone. That failure to reform and drive change within our public sector means that, unlike the Chancellor this morning, it is difficult for us to state that we come to this from a position of strength economically, with a fundamentally strong economy. We need a coordinated response from the executive that will produce a plan to protect our local economy and public services. We need reassurance and leadership to calm markets and encourage investment. We need an emergency plan that can ensure Northern Ireland's voice is heard at Westminster and throughout Europe, and that it is clear in its demands to both protect our funding streams, but also to put in place policies to facilitate our businesses to take advantage of any opportunities that arise. As I said, We need reassurance and leadership, both of which have been in short supply since last Thursday's momentous decision. I urge the Executive to show some urgency, some leadership, and start to plan for this new economic and political environment.
Yeah. Call Ms. Catherine Seeley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Speaking in my capacity as party spokesperson for childcare, children and young people, I can only describe the referendum result as heart-wrenching. The vast majority, three quarters, of 18 to 25-year-olds voted to remain. It would appear, Mr. Speaker, that Thursday was the day young people proved they were much wiser than many others. I therefore want to express solidarity with young people right across Britain who have been let down by inter-party rivalry in a campaign whereby their interests were not at the heart. This again raises the urgent need to extend the vote to 16-year-olds. Their level of engagement in this Scottish referendum was unprecedented. If their vote was good enough then, why not now? Thursday's result will impact more greatly not on those who are 50 plus and who voted in their thousands to leave, but on our children and our children's children, as their opportunities to study, live, love and work in another 27 countries, gaining invaluable life experiences, I won't give way, is snatched away from them. Young people denied opportunities, experiences and friendships, certainly not a legacy to be proud of. Linkages between universities will now be severed. The Erasmus School Exchange Programme called into question. And those young people from our neighbouring countries who have taken a brave step to live and work here now face huge levels of uncertainties. Let there be no doubt, young people will disproportionately bear the brunt and the effects will be long-lasting. I personally have been contacted by friends living, working, studying in Europe, widening their skills gaps, who now say there really is no point in coming home. If unemployment is concerning now, Mr. Speaker, the outlook is increasingly bleak. Our talented and skilled young people staying away when we need them to return home the most. In my constituency of Upper Ban, community projects funded by EU money will now collapse, those in the pipeline suffering a devastating blow. On Friday, I met with representatives from NISM, who represent the ethnic minority community of Upper Ban. Their lives have been thrown into disarray. Families unsure as to where their children will go to school in September and if they will have a job in a month's time. Families, Mr. Speaker, who will endure countless sleepless nights, who now need leaders to step up and reassure them. In the coming days and weeks, Upper Ban will welcome Syrian refugees' families into their communities. I implore my constituents to extend a warm welcome because, sadly, this whole debate has given rise to the type of poisonous politics that we should never have witnessed. The first sign of contagion evident with questions of citizenship posed by a Fianna Fáil TD in the south. As Mr. Stelford pointed out, the civil and human rights we now enjoy were fought hard for, but now lie in the hands of far-right Tories hell-bent on scrapping the Human Rights Act. Not good enough for anyone, particularly our most disadvantaged. I'll give way.
Okay, she mentioned the issue about youth unemployment. Could you tell me what the youth unemployment rate is in Greece?
Spain? Member has an extra minute.
Thank you. Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm most concerned about the unemployment rate here in the north and about the fact that this now means that many of our youth now face a dire future. Mr. Speaker, to conclude, this is not the future our young people voted for. If we do nothing, we greaten the injustice. And I call on all those across Britain and Ireland who favoured Remain to come together and to explore options pertaining to a continuing relationship with our friends in the European Union.
Call Mr. Gordon Lyons.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My first reaction to the result of the EU referendum was to welcome it, and I think an awful lot of people across Northern Ireland will have done the same. My second reaction was that people need to take a breath. People need to relax, and people need to calm down. Yes, we have made a significant decision. Yes, we have made a momentous decision. And yes, there will be huge change in front of us, but I believe that that can be positive change. And by the way, I say to members that they are very foolish if they think that there will be no change with us staying in the European Union, because there is certainly no certainty with remaining within that bloc. Some people have mentioned the uncertainty that is here. People have mentioned stock markets, and it is important to note, of course, that they are no worse off than at certain points over the last number of months. But I'm not surprised that there has been some volatility when you consider the prophets of doom that have been preaching over the last number of months about how terrible that this may be. I'll give way to the member briefly.
I thank the member for giving way. Does he dismiss as prophets of doom those businesses that are trading with the US and have found their costs have risen by 10% over the weekend?
I would say that there are many people, especially in the agricultural community, that were very pleased as well about the exports and the benefits that the change in the pound will have there as well. People mention I give way briefly.
Grateful to the member for giving way. Will the member agree with me that a party that advocated joining the euro was in no position to lecture the rest of us on economics?
I obviously completely agree with what the member said. People have also mentioned uncertainty that can come as a result of the change that we have made by voting to leave the European Union. And there will be uncertainty. Do you know why? Because we're getting control back. There will be decisions that we have to make in terms of agriculture, in terms of trade, in terms of borders, in terms of immigration, in terms of our money. We now have decisions to make because we have that control back. Because those decisions that were previously taken by other people and that were dictated to us by other people, we now have the choice to make about what we do in those areas. We get freedom with this result, and with that freedom comes responsibility, and with that freedom comes the power to decide for ourselves. So I welcome the fact that we will have an opportunity now to make decisions for ourselves. Now, we also do need to accept the result. And I have to say I've been very disappointed by what Mr. Eastwood has said in terms of young people, because this is an argument that's been trotted out over the last number of days, that in some way, because greater numbers of young people voted to remain in the EU, that in some way that means that their votes are worth more or that should be given greater weight. We have democracy in this country. We have one man and we have one vote, and I thought that is something that the members will welcome. My time is going. I'll not be giving way because my time is going on. I've already given way a couple of times. We are part of the UK. We have voted to leave, and those that are calling for a second referendum are only injecting uncertainty into the future. And it is also, by the way, a smack in the face of those who have decided to leave, and those are the people who so often feel that they're ignored by the elites in this country. So we do, Madam Deputy Speaker, have time to prepare. We have 2 years, and we know that our First Minister and Deputy First Minister will work with Brussels, will work with Westminster to ensure that we are in a good position as we negotiate our way outside of the European Union. Madam Deputy Speaker, I do want to say that although there has been so much negativity around this decision, I believe now is time to embrace the possibilities that actually come with us leaving the European Union. We have decided to leave a bloc of countries that stifled jobs, that hampered trade, that hurt agriculture, and by the way, we paid for the pleasure of doing all of that. And we are now in a position where we can march forward and be stronger than ever before. I believe in the creativity of our people. I believe in their hard work. I believe in their industry. And I believe in our ability to push the boundaries and make further progress for future generations. I'll give way to Mr. Eastwood. Yes.
Thank you. And I know he addressed some of the things I said, and I'm maybe not going to that now, but just for the record, I don't believe that anybody, no matter what age they are, or no matter what background they're from, that their vote should be worth more than anybody else's, and that's been our position since our foundation, and maybe a wee look into history would be useful for the member. Can I ask him to tell me how much of the money saved that you're telling us is going to be saved by not being members of the European Union is going to have to be ploughed in to the banks that are publicly owned that have lost fortunes upon fortunes in this last couple of days?
I ask that all members make their remarks through the chair.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I do know that we're going to have an awful lot more money back now in order for us to spend in the way that we want, and we're going to have that freedom, and we are now going to have that control. So I welcome the result of this referendum, and I know that the First Minister and the Deputy First Minister will work to ensure that we get a good deal, but I believe that we have very good days ahead because of the possibilities and the opportunities that leaving the EU will afford us.
I call Claire Hannah, Éireann Saoire Claire Hannah.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. For those I've been speaking to over the weekend, the overwhelming emotions are still shock and anxiety. And as much as the party across want to gloss over the arguments and the myth-making of the last few months, for something this major, I'm going to get into underway, for this major, we're entitled to ask who did this and why. And as an Assembly, it's our job to chart some sort of a course and to play the hand that we've been dealt with, not just for people who voted for Remain, but for all those people who are going to be affected by this. And that does include people who were too young to vote. I'm not just saying that a younger person's vote is certainly not worth any more than anybody else, but also for the tens of thousands of people from the European Union who come here, who work hard here, who pay into our system, who didn't get a vote and who have been scapegoated for every problem of the world. We warned about the carnival of reaction that would follow Brexit, and we're seeing it now. We're seeing market instability, we're seeing the beginnings of job loss announcements, and we're seeing the two UK government parties essentially setting themselves on fire. The polls show I will give way.
Just as a question and a degree of clarification, Madam Deputy Speaker, the figure that we were talking about, the instability brought by the other member, is now £260 billion and rising. That's a lot more than $8.5 billion. Sorry.
And I am going to get through
his points,
but those who set themselves up as defenders of the Union and of the Empire should look at the polls in Scotland and be very, very careful about what they have wished for. Would the member sit down, please? I'm going to make a few points. The member has had. The member can sit down. I don't know what you're laughing about. You have lost this year. Those who led... Why don't you have to take my seat?
I hope the member isn't challenging the chair. Can the member take her seat? We'll have order and respect in this House, and all remarks to the chair.
Those who led the Leave campaign have essentially gone AWOL. Your friends are popping up in the media to basically roll back on a lot of the spoofs they put out over the last few months on extra money to the NHS, on the ending of free movement of people, on when Article 50 would be triggered, and, as the member has said, the fact that the quarter of a trillion that had to be pumped in to stand up the pound today represents 20 years of EU contributions. The members across talk about the disenfranchised and the forgotten. How are those people going to feel whenever they find out clearly that they were lied to and that their opportunity and their financial stability were thrown away for a handful of magic sovereignty beans? There is now no plan. No, I'm not, because I have given away quite some time. There's now no plan, and for the First Minister of Northern Ireland to say that despite there being no plan, we will wash up the same creek that the UK government find themselves in without a paddle is a dereliction of duty. This result was a leap into the unknown, and people here knew that, and a majority of people wanted to stay in Europe and the stability and the opportunity and the cooperation it offers, and we have to try and give that up. The DUP, who want to pick and choose which majorities the DUP who refused to accept the democratic will of the people, 70% of whom voted for the Good Friday Agreement, the DUP who refused to accept that a majority in this Assembly and a majority of the UK support equal marriage, so you choose which issues you're going to veto. The DUP, who said that the majority in Scotland not to vote for independence last time, which is smaller than the majority that you got, is somehow decisive and settled, and that this majority isn't. You can't pick and choose on these things. And for the members who want to make this a green and orange issue is another dereliction of duty. We also need a government that represents everybody here and not party interests. And I think knee-jerk calls for a border poll were the last thing that we need. We have just seen over the last few months the atavistic passions that arises in people, including people without a history of recent violent extremism. And a woman, an MP and a young mum is dead because of that. We are too fragile to have that sort of instability. We spent the last 4 months telling you that Leave was a leap into the unknown and a border poll was. But I'll tell you this, the relationship between moderate nationalists and moderate unionists between the United Kingdom is fundamentally and recklessly altered. The social democratic benefits like the National Health Service and stability and the tolerance are now on their way out, are being taken out. The principle of consent that we all adhere to in the Good Friday Agreement has been breached. The constitutional status of Northern Ireland cannot change without the... No, the member is going to get through some of her own points. Whatever your views on the logic of Scottish unity, they did their homework, and we haven't done our homework on maxing out devolution, and we haven't done our homework on Irish unity yet. We need to do that. We need to do that, but forcing that instability onto people would be reckless in the extreme. How we move forward, let's not forget that we do have the most imaginative constitutional settlement here, possibly anywhere in the world, that allows people here to be British or Irish or both as they so choose, and you can't just write that away. And good political and legal minds wrote that while the party across were marching up and down the driveway, by the way, taking no part in the solutions, but solutions can be found. We're due later today to discuss the budget, to discuss how we're going to get corporation tax, because that's the basket we've put all our eggs in, when every single foreign direct investor said they wanted us stable, they wanted us skilled, and they wanted us as a gateway to Europe. Those on the left, by the way, who put their ideological purity over public services and people, have forfeited the right to complain about the hardship that the block grant being thumped is going to bring. I'm not given to quoting poetry, but I will in the last. Yeats said, "A terrible beauty is born. All is changed utterly." He also said, "If the centre cannot hold, the centre, the majority, voted for Europe, and it's the will, it's the duty of this assembly to represent that sense, to represent that
member's time centre." I call Lord Morrow.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. We've heard a lot today. We've heard a lot over the weekend since this poll has taken place, and people don't like it when the little people speak. And when people are given their democratic right, there's something infinitely wrong with that, in particular from those opposite. They'll soon get to the stage, I suppose, there'll be sections of our community and our great nation will not be allowed to vote because they just mightn't do it the way the people here that want them to do it. But the little people have spoken, and I must say that I welcome the decision that they have taken. And for those who are confused today, they are confusing themselves, because let it be loudly stated, Northern Ireland is an integral part of the United Kingdom. This was not a referendum in Northern Ireland. It was a referendum of all the people of the United Kingdom. Now, I listened to Ms. Hannah. She came very close. She was tantamount to saying it. What has been said by the Remain camp? What did they promise us if we voted to leave? Third World War, an emergency budget, and poverty would be our lot for the rest of our lives. They have absolutely no confidence in themselves. They have no confidence in the country in which they live in, and they just want to play it down all the time. Mr. Nesbitt has still failed to tell us which part of the Ulster Unionist Party he speaks for. Does he speak for Tom Elliott MP? Does he speak for Lord Rogan? Does he speak for Councillor McGimsey? Tell us which section of the party do you speak for. I'll let you in later. I've heard this long enough. But, Principal Deputy Speaker, can I say this? The EU referendum was a momentous democratic moment for the United Kingdom. The decision to leave is without question one of the biggest political moments which any of us have experienced. For me, the decision to leave is the right one for the United Kingdom. For me, the decision to leave couldn't have been better. I believe that the United Kingdom will not only survive outside the European Union, but in fact, I think it will flourish. We have left a shrinking union for a better place in the world. We no longer have to put up with the undemocratic nature of the European Union. Thankfully, we'll not be subject to that any longer. No longer will those making consequential decisions for the people of the UK be beyond the reach of accountability. It is my view that the UK has voted to take back control of our own affairs, and that is a very positive thing. I respect the fact that for many in the UK and in Northern Ireland, the decision to leave the European Union is one that they do not welcome. I understand why some desire to remain within the Union and voted that way. I was not one of them. It is my hope in the years to come that those of us who desire to leave the EU will be able to win round some of those who wanted us to remain, as the benefits of being outside the EU become apparent. There has been hysterical response, and we've heard some of it here today, in some quarters to the decision to leave. From what we have heard in the media, you would imagine that the sky is about to fall in. Well, I can tell all members, relax, the sky is still in place. It hasn't come down just yet. And the four horsemen of the apocalypse are about to make their appearance in the aftermath of this vote. It's not going to happen. Many commentators seem to be on the mission to talk the United Kingdom down. We are apparently too poor and we are too weak to make our own way in the world. In my view and the view of my party, the UK is a strong country with the fifth highest economy in the world. We can and will thrive outside the European Union. What we do not need right now is the sort of hysterical response that we're getting from that quarter over there. Yes, it is the case that the UK will face significant challenges in the months and years ahead. Political leaders in Northern Ireland will need to think carefully about questions such as the status of the border with the Republic of Ireland and our trading relationships with countries around the world. Now is a time for cool heads. We need a cross-party approach to consider carefully how we in Northern Ireland can best thrive outside the European Union. We need to be willing to listen to the wisdom of both those who desire to remain outcome and those who voted leave in considering how we go forward. This country has the intelligence and capability to thrive regardless of whether we are.
I call Jennifer McCann.
Madam Deputy Speaker, Principal Deputy Speaker, I just want to start off by saying that, you know, I've been listening to this debate from I came into the chamber this morning, and really, you know, we're listening to a lot of grandstanding. We're listening to a lot of people who are saying this was a victory for the ordinary person on the street and the ordinary person in society and everything else. And I'm confused, and I don't know what people out there must be whenever they're listening in, if they are listening in or listening in later on to this. Because the people that we should be talking about in this chamber today are the people who live in the north of Ireland. That's the people who we should be talking about. We should be talking about the people who voted to remain, not the people who voted to leave. Because the people that elected us and the people that we represent are the people who live in the north of Ireland, and they voted to remain. And that being said, I just want to break this down to the actual realities, because I think sometimes a dose of reality is needed in a debate like this. And this morning I went to a community organisation in West Belfast. I visited a community organisation. And that community organisation has services for children with severe disabilities and complex needs, and they help support the families of those children as well. And I have to say, it is organisations and groups like that and the services that they deliver that is going to be impacted by this. Not the people that you're grandstanding about and you're talking about in terms of this great empire, whatever you're talking about. It's the ordinary people on the street, the ordinary children with disabilities, their families, women's organisations, community organisations right across the piece in all constituencies, and all people in this chamber represent. And we know from recent times that the cuts that have already came to those particular community and voluntary organisations are going to become even worse in this, with this here result. And what is going to happen is, do you really, really believe, does anybody in this chamber believe that the money that isn't going to go to Europe is going to come here? Does anybody really seriously believe that? When we look at the Tory austerity programmes that have already been put in place and the policies, how can anyone seriously get up here today and say that the community services that is in those communities that are going to go because of the structural funds going, because of the peace funds going, because of the ESF funds going, can anyone really seriously believe that they're going to be replaced? Because I certainly don't, and I'm not convinced with anything that I've already heard here today.
And I just want to touch on the voluntary and community sector in particular, because particularly the peace monies, and I'm talking about peace monies that have been here from 2007, and hope, well, we thought we were going to be here to 2020 at least, but might not be now. Those monies were put in to build positive relationships between our communities here. And again, we saw young people availing of that, we saw women's organisations availing of that, and we saw people in local communities availing of all those services. And it actually helped to build those spaces and that place where we needed that space for people to come together. I mean, even in the constituencies like West Belfast, and I see people at the other part of the benches here representing West Belfast, there was a small organisation called Our City, and it was a youth organisation that came in terms of from the Hammer and the Shankill and from Ardoyne. And those two sets of young people came together in a neutral place where they could come together, and they went out to Africa, South Africa, to help other underprivileged children and children who were less fortunate than themselves. And for some of those young people, and myself and my DUP colleague, who was junior minister at the time, went out to visit their organisation. And some of those young people who were 15 and 16 years of age had never once even came together to meet somebody from a different community background. But that money was able to actually bring those young people together, to help bring those young people together in that space where they could go out and help people in a different country.
The member then therefore agree that the result of this referendum will disproportionately affect our young people and our future generation?
The member has an extra minute.
I think it will, and I also believe, because a lot of the victims and survivors' money comes from Europe as well, this is going to impact really seriously on the ordinary people out there. So I would plead with people in this chamber today to go with a united voice, to show leadership whenever we are going, wherever we're going to do that. Because people out there are very, very concerned. People in communities are very concerned. Families are very concerned about their services. People from ethnic minority backgrounds are very, very concerned. And I would make a plea that we need to send a unified voice out. Yeah.
Giving way, and I pay tribute to Alan Waite and the people who work on that project as well. But does the member really think that the speech that she has just delivered to this House provides him and his colleagues and the young people in that project with any comfort at all? Is she not raising the fears that the colleagues sitting to her right raised whenever she was speaking as well? We should be looking to play down and give people certainty and surety, not raise people's concerns.
There isn't any certainty, and that's why I'm speaking the way I am, because in terms of the community and the voluntary sector, in the terms of the community and voluntary sector, that is what's going to impact on ordinary people and ordinary families out there.
Madam Principal, Deputy Speaker, at the outset, can I say it is appropriate that we are having this debate today, and it is a shame that it is the opposition that is bringing this to the floor. This is a matter that affects all of us. It's perhaps the most serious issue to face this Assembly during its entire existence, and indeed perhaps the most serious issue facing the UK since the Second World War. Let me also be very clear that I do indeed accept that this is a UK-wide vote, and we have to respect the outcome of that, no matter what position we took in terms of that referendum, and we have to deal with the consequences and implications that flow from it. But equally, it would be wrong to work on the basis that the UK is a unitary state and that we're all now lumped in it together in terms of where we go in terms of the future. The very name of the UK is the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Northern Ireland. We're very familiar with the fact that we have separate football teams, for example, and as an aside, well done to Northern Ireland. I'm sure the House will join me in congratulating them on their outstanding success in the Euros. And we have the reality of devolution in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. Scotland is a kingdom with its own separate history, and they have now established a principle that they can do things differently. We in Northern Ireland are very much a place apart, particularly in the context of our land border on the island of Ireland. And we also have our own very particular constitutional settlement based around the Good Friday Agreement with the three stranded sets of relationships and, importantly, the ability of the people of Northern Ireland to determine their own particular future through the principle of consent. Though while that is, to be accurate, only framed in terms of the issue of whether we're part of the UK or whether we're part of United Ireland, I make that point, however, to stress that we do have the ability to take our own decisions and that we are a separate place in terms of how we are seen, in terms of the UK as a whole, and indeed the European Union and the wider world. The consequences and implications of Brexit are going to be massive and far-reaching, certainly for Northern Ireland, for the UK as a whole, the island of Ireland, and indeed the rest of the European Union. And we could see a lot of dominoes falling over the coming months and years. We have set ourselves on a path to which we do not know where we're going in terms of the destination. Certainly staying in did have a certain degree of risks and uncertainty, but that's nothing like where we find ourselves today. I hear comments from people, most recently Lord Morrow, about the importance of taking control. That was the mantra of those who advocated taking us out of the European Union. Let's be clear today. No one is in control. We have an absolute mess. We have Boris Johnson scrambling around. I think as one commentator put it, trying to find the pin to put back in the hand grenade he set off. We are in a situation where there is no leadership whatsoever. No one is taking control of the situation. There was no plan before in terms of what happens in terms of a vote to leave, and there's no plan today as to where we're going to be going.
I thank the member for giving way. And would he agree with me that the whole argument, like many of the arguments of the Leave campaign to take control, was an English argument? Because as we've seen, with the majority of people in Northern Ireland voting to remain, we're not actually in control.
The member will have an extra minute.
Yes, I certainly concur with the point that the member has made. And I need to press on. Let me be very clear as well that in terms of this issue about this is about the ordinary people versus the elites, the establishment. We've had a lot of comments that have been very disparaging of those people who voted to stay in. They're ordinary people as well. This is fundamentally a battle between the Tory establishment. This is not establishment versus the people. This is a fight within the Tory establishment with the people of the UK as their plaything. Yes.
When I was on the referendum programme on the night that the votes were being counted, I said the very first thing that I said was, I love my country and I believe the people that voted to remain love their country as well. I don't think anyone will be able to point to anything that either I or any of my colleagues have said that disparages people who voted to remain.
At the start of the member's comments, he referred to the victory of the ordinary people. The people on the other side of the argument are also ordinary people, so hopefully that addresses that. Let me come to the crux of the issue that where we find ourselves as an executive and an assembly, and in particular for the DUP. Northern Ireland has voted to remain. That is a matter of fact, and we also are a separate entity within the context of the overall UK. There's an issue for the First Minister as to whether she and her party are going to recognise those special circumstances in terms of how we move ahead. And arising from that, is there going to be the capacity within the executive? I need to move on. Sorry. Is there going to be the capacity within the executive and the assembly to actually argue for Northern Ireland in terms of taking into account our special circumstances? Is there going to be any capacity to seek any special modifications or recognition of any special status for Northern Ireland? Those are issues that are very much on the minds of the people of Northern Ireland and the business community that we find ourselves today. Because let's be clear, there are many, many issues ahead of us that we have to address in terms of access to the single market. And that is the biggest single issue why companies want to invest in Northern Ireland. Let's not kid ourselves. The future of our public finances, which are already precarious, and we're facing a shrinkage of the Northern Ireland economy. And for the benefit of Lord Morrow, the reason that we're saying we're the sixth largest economy rather than the fifth is that overnight with the Leave vote we moved with France overtaking the UK. There's implications for the Good Friday Agreement, implications for our border, where the border is going to be in terms of free movement of people and the free movement of goods. These are all issues that the executive have to take control on and provide us with answers. Thank you.
Before I call Steve Aiken, there are many people making comments from sedentary position and I'd ask them to refrain from doing so. I call Steve Aiken.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. The Ulster Unionist Party respects the wishes of the British people, whilst clearly recognising that both Northern Ireland and Scotland have, by a considerable majority, voted to remain within the EU. It is also clear that a significant constitutional crisis, the like of which the United Kingdom is rarely seen as incurring. Indeed, the turmoil in the country, in the markets, and the palpable lack of confidence being shown on our political systems are undermining Northern Ireland and, in particular, our economy. We have already heard from many business leaders that there will be a slowdown in investment and a shutting down on the flow of FDI until confidence in the United Kingdom is restored. What we do know is that when the United Kingdom's economy slows down, our economy in Northern Ireland stalls or goes into deep recession. We hope we are wrong, but hope is no basis for planning or helping to secure and retain jobs and to restore confidence. We also know over the coming months and years that the economy of Northern Ireland will be very low on the priority list of the United Kingdom government, especially as issues of Scotland, possible general election, gaining trading arrangements with the EU and restoring faith in the United Kingdom political system will be taking up the majority of our mainland politicians' time. We must act now to take control of our own economy and the best interests of Northern Ireland. We as a party would like to call the Northern Ireland Executive to urgently enact discussions and think about legislating to help recover confidence for our business sector, especially for our manufacturing sectors, agribusiness, tourism, retail and, above all, our many small and medium enterprises. And rather than just stating the obvious and rapidly growing problems, we ask that some of these proposals are given full consideration. We would ask, therefore, that the Executive, and particularly the Economy, Infrastructure and Finance Ministers, considering talking with the Bank of England and talking with the Treasury, looking to gain some access to infrastructure and infrastructure support funds. We can look at the amount of quantitative easing that's already been passed to the banks in the region of $250 billion. We as Northern Ireland should be making a special case to look for additional funding to be able to get us through that position as well. We need to stimulate our economy. We should be immediately looking at tax reductions, particularly corporation tax, stimulating our tourist sector and scrapping things like APD now. We know that those may not be devolved matters, but the situation has changed. We need to be looking on as well. We could also be improving support for our retail sector and looking and taking on the initiatives that NERDA have been raising about to retail business rate relief and looking to do that now. We should also start the process of easing our renewable energy requirements, our energy industry, to reduce the cost of energy in Northern Ireland. That might be a benefit of us coming out of the EU. We need to take immediate provision now to invest in our universities. We have already heard our university's vice-chancellors talking about the £55 million black hole. We need to be preparing Northern Ireland to be as competitive as possible, particularly since we're heading into particular difficult times. And we should be looking to see how we can fast-track infrastructure developments across the board. We need to make Northern Ireland competitive. If we don't do it, nobody else is going to do it. And I would like the Executive, and particularly now, thank you very much indeed, Deputy First Minister, for coming in. I would like the First Minister and Deputy First Minister to be putting Northern Ireland first. If we don't fight for the Northern Ireland economy, nobody else will. Thank you very much indeed.
Well, Jonathan Bell.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. What has become very clear is that the United Kingdom has spoken, and it has conclusively spoken. And it is now incumbent on all of the politicians, and I accept there were different views and there were different arguments, and some of the arguments may not have been presented on either side as best as they could have been. However, the United Kingdom has spoken. This wasn't an individual country referendum. This was a United Kingdom referendum. And they have spoken. And it is now incumbent upon every politician to follow the people's instructions. And that result, it's clear. So now is the time for all of us to unite, to seize what I believe will be a golden opportunity for all of the people of the United Kingdom. Some of the fears that were out there, we don't need to worry about. The Chancellor is out this morning. There is not going to be an emergency punishment budget. I don't think I've heard any air raid sirens. There is not going to be World War III. And I will in a moment. And we are not going to see our economy significantly damage, given the opportunities that are opening up. Let me tell you that when we joined the European Union, as I understand it, the European Union had 36% of the world's economy. Today, it has 17% of the world's economy. And the United Kingdom, our United Kingdom, that has voted to take back control, to set its own taxes, and to free itself to laws that serve the people of the United Kingdom, are one of only two of the current 28 members of the European Union that do more trade with the rest of the world than they do with the European Union. So now is the time. Can I say something to pensioners out there who I believe older people, in a very ageist way, have been discriminated against and derogatory comments made about, and I'm sure I'm not alone in saying the derogatory nature of these are people who are voting who don't have time to live. Disgraceful comments, because we should remember that while unemployment and youth unemployment is falling in Northern Ireland, we seem to want, by the member opposite, to be tackled to the youth unemployment of Greece at 48.9%, Spain 45.3%, Croatia 40.3%, Italy 39.1%. Seriously? At 13.4% by the official figures of the UK under 25. We want to feel our people the way they have been failed by the European Union. I don't think our young people will buy that argument. The member opposite first, and I'll give it.
I mean, the danger of quoting statistics, would he also, if he has the list, quote the figures from the Netherlands, Denmark, Sweden, Finland, Germany, Austria, and also just outside the European Union, but part of the single market, Switzerland? Are we talking about youth unemployment?
And the member has an extra minute.
Thank you. I'll continue for the member if he wants. Cyprus 30.5%, Portugal 30%, Belgium 25%, France 24.6%. The member goes.
I thank the member for giving way. Would the member agree with me that there has been an awful lot of negativity from those who lost in the referendum? Although we can understand that some people are very disappointed with the result, we can understand that, we can empathise with that. Shouldn't our focus now be on trying to, as the result has now been declared, that everybody should accept that and actually look in a positive way in how we can build an even better country?
Absolutely. We need to move forward in a positive fashion. The BDI, the German equivalent of the CBI, let's everybody just take a moment. What have they told us today? Free trade will continue. Access to the single market will continue. And the only thing we seem to be freed from is the sclerotic and opaque legislation of the corpus of European Union law, from which there can be no appeal. It's a golden opportunity for the United Kingdom. But let me thank the older people of this country, because while others may choose to be derogatory about them, let me tell you it was the older people of this country that founded and built our National Health Service. It was the pensioners of this country that won two world wars. It was them that built our industry. It was the older people of this country that put the United Kingdom to be the fifth largest economy in the world. And is anybody saying to me, with the value today, as the fifth largest economy, a value in sterling, I believe, of £2.31 million, we cannot build a future for our own young people? Is anybody telling me, with the third largest defence capability on this planet, that we are not capable of defending our own people? Member,
sorry,
but the
speaker gave way.
Oh, come on. Madam Deputy Speaker.
I'm grateful to the member for giving way. The member recalled, the member from Belfast South said that the people that she has been speaking to have all been in agreement with her that this is a dreadful thing. Is that not exactly what was wrong with the Remain campaign? You only talked to people that agreed with you.
In 10 seconds, Principal Deputy Speaker.
10 seconds. It might be useful where you are taking the intervention if you identify who you're taking the intervention from.
10 seconds in conclusion, what the global economy needs into the future is flexibility, adaptability, and control over our own destiny. That's why I believe the majority of UK
time
went
is
for
up.
Us.
I call the member's time is up.
And
I call Kiva.
Would
the member please? Would the member
please
take his seat? The member's time was up, and his time was called. I call Kiva Archibald.
We've already heard a great deal this afternoon about the uncertainty of the result of last Thursday referendum. And arguably, there's no sector more impacted than agriculture. And the real problem is the uncertainty. Our farmers and consequently our rural communities have no idea of the outworkings or implications of this result. We raised this time and again throughout the referendum campaign that those campaigning to leave had not outlined what their plan would be for the agriculture sector upon an exit from the European Union. We had platitudes that our farmers would of course still receive subsidies, but no information as to what those subsidies might comprise. Taking into account that 9% of the total CAP funding, which comes from the EU to Britain in the north, comes to here in the six counties, those subsidies are a very significant concern to farmers here. But it would seem we're now in a situation where there is no plan and we have no idea what the future will hold for the sector. There will obviously be a period of time when negotiations will take place, and during that time we are assured that the funding which was committed will remain in place. And that funding is very significant, some £1.8 million of CAP funding and Rural Development Programme funding. However, the problem is we do not know when that period of negotiation will begin or how long it will last. Therefore, we do not know how long those funds will be available. It is important to reiterate how much our farmers rely on funding that the EU afforded it, some £236 million in direct payments annually. And without these direct support payments, farm incomes would have been negative last year and in three of the previous 5 years. Any reduction in direct support would leave many of our farmers in severe financial difficulty, with very negative implications for agricultural.
Go ahead. Obviously, I presume the member was voting to remain, but could the member have given any assurance to the farmers that the subsidies would have continued into the near future?
And the member will have an extra minute.
Well, we were certain that the direct payments would remain until 2020 in any situation. I haven't even touched yet upon the impact on the rural sector. The last Rural Development Programme had a very positive impact on our rural communities, with rural communities being able to access funding for community projects and rural infrastructure. The new Rural Development Programme offered even greater potential, and we are now uncertain how long that programme will last, and therefore planned community programmes will likely suffer or could become untenable. Now that we're looking at an exit from the EU, there are other significant issues which need to be addressed, including legislative arrangements, trade arrangements, etc., which affect all sectors, including agriculture. And it should be pointed out that although not part of the EU, Iceland, Norway, Liechtenstein, etc., as part of the European Economic Area, for trade purposes have to comply with a range of food safety, environmental and veterinary legislation in order to trade. A major change has taken place.
Except that both Norway and Switzerland are reckoned both first and second in the Legatum Prosperity Index, and both rejected the EU by 79 and 82% respectively.
Well, my concern is with the north of Ireland and the issues for our farmers. A major change has taken place over the last few days, and the uncertainty which has resulted has already affected our economy severely. It was mentioned earlier this may have a short-term positive impact on export prices, but longer-term this uncertainty will result in many farmers reconsidering their future in the industry, which may impact upon production. We need direction and we need some certainty for all sectors of our society. Gormagat.
Patsy McGlone. I call Patsy McGlone.
Gormagat, a frio lascion corlia. Thanks very much indeed, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. As I stand here today, I feel I have to reiterate for the benefit of some people why I have bought the European project. And we have to clarify to ourselves why in the first instance it was set up. It is the world's largest international peace process. Fundamentally, that's what was at its core. As Europe ravaged itself after two world wars, people and leaders saw the need to come together in the spirit of peace, in the spirit of reconciliation, and ultimately accommodation of difference. Now, and I don't rate any jocularity in the week that's in it, the anniversary of the Somme, anybody thinking that a world war is anything to make jokes about. I feel that the spirit, the true spirit of the EU is as important today as it was on previous occasions with its foundation. Yep.
Okay.
I thank the member for giving way. Would he agree with me that it was never the case that Remain argued that an exit from the EU would lead to World War III? It was simply that we stated quite correctly, as the member has said, that it had made a tangible contribution to stability and peace in Europe over the last number of years.
I thank the member for making that comment. It's crucially important one. Members may not appreciate that, but that's the way it is, and that's the way I see it. And that's why, I have other comments to make here, that's why I see it as important for stability, important for a social driver, and important for cultural accommodation and diversity within our communities. Now, that stability is crucially important. The fact that 440,707 people within Northern Ireland here bought that. They saw the importance of that. They saw the importance of stability. They saw the importance of the future and buying into that future. And just there are a number of other facts that we need to solidify around this chamber. As a consequence of what happened on Thursday, that vote, the UK slipped into sixth place as an economy. As a direct consequence of that, we saw the run on the currencies. We have heard about other firms that are moving their location as a direct consequence of that. And on that very point, I sat as chair of the Enterprise Committee within this Assembly and took evidence around the important issue, as it was then, of corporation tax. Many of the people who gave that evidence to that committee, including key stakeholders, potential business people and the like, saw access to the European markets on mainland Europe as a key factor in their making a decision here to invest here. So those are the important things. We have also seen the consequentials of people taking a two-way bet and getting for their passports, and indeed I've noticed that. People from all backgrounds doing that. However, the biggest lie of the lot was this 350 million, some of which or all of which would go towards the health service. Already two of the authors of that misleading part of the campaign have backed off from that, Boris Johnson and Nigel Farage. Now, people bought that lie. People had the concerns, they bought that lie. And now it's turned out exactly for that, a free Olaskion call you. Economy stability, a key element of exports from the north and cooperation from the north here is to the rest of the island. I just quote a person who came up to me. Now, I would hardly go as far as to call him a left-wing radical. He was a lorry driver. He said to me, Patsy, am I back to this stupidity of having to line up at the border for a couple of hours to get clearance on my delivery documents if I'm travelling down to County Clare, as he often does? That's a question, hardly from a member of the ruling political elite. The other elements of it were, and I'll just move on to them. I had one young mum who came to me on Friday morning in tears, thinking about the future of her kids and the stability of the society that she was looking at now. I'll work my way through them. Again, the elites. Again, the lefty liberals. Again, the political establishment and political elite that has been referred to. No, I don't think so. I'm talking about the small farmers concerned about the single farm payments or basic payments now. I'm talking about people who had opportunities or saw opportunities under the LAG programme to develop projects within our rural communities to offset the problems and difficulties they're having with world trade prices for their beef and for their milk. Yes, the small man or the little man. They're concerned, deeply concerned, about the instability that is brought about by this. The students, those concerned about the Horizon 2020 programme, the peace monies for the community groups. I'll give another example. I attended an event for the opening of a mental health charity on Friday morning. One-third of their project monies comes from European Social Fund. And Erasmus schools as well. So, Gura Mayagat, Frio Lash Concordia.
I call Roy Beggs.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Speaker.
Everyone in Northern Ireland purports to be Democrat, certainly everyone in here. And I think we should reflect on what that actually means. There is responsible for everyone to accept democratic decisions. Some appear in their comments to be disputing this decision of a referendum. Can I remind everyone that in the Belfast Agreement, what was agreed was that Northern Ireland would remain within the United Kingdom until the people of Northern Ireland decided otherwise. I accept that there's a great deal of uncertainty around and affecting the future economy of Northern Ireland and the United Kingdom from this decision, but nevertheless, it is democratically accepted that Northern Ireland is an integral part of the United Kingdom and will remain so. So we have to accept the decisions that have been taken by that national United Kingdom referendum, irrespective of what side of the argument anyone was on. We need to get away from the futile argument of whether or not it will apply here or not, or whether it will apply in Scotland or not. It will apply here. Let's move on and let's try and get the debate onto more constructive ground as to how we must react. Northern Ireland businesses and their employees need clarity and certainty, and they want to know what can be done to give that to them. We need to accept that the decision is taken and get on to the debate of what future measures come in. What else can we do to try and provide protection? Some 40% of our exports in the United Kingdom, and there's no reason to think it's any different here, goes to the EU. We must ensure that those companies will be continuing to export and sell their goods, and that employees will still be employed. Let's get away from the futile argument that there has been here. Certainly won't.
I thank the member for giving way. Isn't it important for this House, indeed the country, to remember that just because we have left the European Union, that we're not severing all ties with the European Union, it's still going to be an important trading partner? And also, further to Mr. McGlone's comments, we can still have cooperation and foster good relationships with the European Union, even though we're outside of it.
It'll be coming to that part later. But it's not just about the firms that are exporting in Northern Ireland. Anybody that deals with a firm that exports to Europe, their business can be affected if we do not get stable grounds for business in Northern Ireland. Those trading with others could be implications for their business. Equally, there are ramifications for the many organisations in Northern Ireland who have been to date receiving European grants. The Social Fund, the Peace Fund, the Regional Development Fund, funding for the rural community. There needs to be greater clarity and certainty going forward. What are the implications for all those? And then we have this particular issue in Northern Ireland with the land border. There's considerable trade across that land border. Now, whether that is Caterpillar in Larne selling a major generator to a company in the Republic of Ireland, or whether it is a small farmer selling some of his milk to a creamery in Monaghan, there are possible implications for both, and we need to ensure that trade will be able to continue and that jobs will be continuing to be employed in Northern Ireland. If we don't get solutions, enough of what decision was in the past, the decision is taken. What we need now is solutions so that trade can occur and companies can continue in business. We must not dwell in the past. We must look at what the future arrangements will be, both what will be best for a United Kingdom perspective and from a Northern Ireland perspective. And we must try and give reassurance. And I would draw members' attention to a paper I came across from a Dr. Richard North, along with Robert Oles of the Bruges Group. And it was entitled Market Solutions. And in it, it talks of the need for compromise. And there will be need for compromise and the need for staging posts in his ideal future solutions. There are choices available, but anyone here has to recognise that it takes decades to get a bespoke agreement with the European community. Look at the recent trade agreement with Canada. The Swift model has transformed over years. Are we looking for a Swiss model? Are we looking for the Norwegian model? We probably will have to accept something off the shelf that will come reasonably quick, or it will take years and years which you cannot afford. But we have to accept what there is in some of these models. There are things that some people will not like. We will have the freedom of trade, which is essential for our companies and business. But there will also be freedom of movements of people, some of which have been opposed. And there is also a slight issue of having to pay a significant tax for the access to Europe. So what we need is solutions. We need to move this forward. And I notice as whilst we're speaking here, the pound is now at a low. It's gone down further. It's now at €1.20. This is affecting businesses. It's affecting real jobs in our economy. And we need solutions. And we need to get away from futile argument. And we need to get solutions that will help our companies and businesses to protect jobs for the future.
As question time begins at 2 o'clock, I suggest the House take its ease until then. This debate will continue after question time, when the next member to speak will be Alex Atwood.
Turn to the debate on the withdrawal of the United Kingdom from the European Union. Point of order.
Mr. Speaker, I'd just like to apologise to yourself and to the House for not being present for supplementary questions or topical questions.
Members, we now return to the debate on the withdrawal of the United Kingdom from the European Union. I call on Mr. Alex Atwood, and the member has up to 5 minutes. Mr. Atwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Could I first of all say that from where we sit and from all the people that I've been speaking to virtually over the weekend, there is a palpable sense of loss in respect of the vote last week, a sense of loss of place, loss of who we are and want to be, loss of influence, loss of identity and loss of funds. And I say that, Mr. Deputy Speaker, because the bombastic approach taken by some in the DUP during this debate this morning is in marked contrast with the scale of the decision and its consequences that were made last week. And I hope that the bombastic approach of the few is replaced by a more discerning approach by the many. I hope that that is gathered, even in the last hour or two, has been better understood by the DUP. There's been some discussion, Mr. Deputy Speaker, about how has nationalism responded to the vote last week. Well, speaking on behalf of those who have been democratic and nationalists, without apology and without exception over the last 45 years of the SDLP, we do find the decision last week upsetting, game-changing, and with immense consequences. And maybe, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that's quite natural, because for the democratic nationalist tradition on this island, be it in the north or be it in the south, we did define ourselves more in the identity of being European. We were more influenced by John Hume and his recognition that the European project was the biggest peace project in the Western world, and that we were more attached to the three strands of the Good Friday Agreement and its unspoken fourth strand, namely of accommodating difference within the European context. So I think that there is a sense of loss and bewilderment and upset and even anger within nationalism and republicanism. But I sense that there is also that to some degree within unionism, because the figures will confirm, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that a greater percentage pro rata of unionists in Northern Ireland voted to remain than the percentage of nationalists who voted to leave. And for all those reasons, and well, the figures will confirm that, for all those reasons, the scale of what happened last week in terms of the politics and culture of this island need to be recognised. That is not, Mr. Deputy Speaker, a rush to a vote for vote's sake when it comes to the existence of some of the border, which has been the approach of some in recent days. It is to recognise, Mr. Deputy Speaker, that because of last Thursday, there is now a different dynamic in the politics of this island and these islands than there has been at any time over the last 50 years, and that the consequence of that, in my view, and this is why I am hopeful and positive about the future, is that people will begin to reimagine the future different from the past and try to make the future bigger and bolder than the good that we have achieved in the past. Can I say, especially to the First Minister, that in the management over the next, of this issue over the next 2 years, the scale of this cannot be handled, as Mark Durkin put it to the Assembly group this morning, through usual diplomatic channels. That the paradigm has changed, and it has changed utterly. And those in the DUP and elsewhere in politics in the North who want to put all their eggs in the Boris basket will quickly learn how shallow a strategy that is. That is why the SDLP again today calls on the Irish government to invite the parties in the North and in the South to come together in a forum for the future, so that, I will shortly, so that we recognise the paradigm shift that occurred last Thursday, and that we recognise that to rely upon London in the next 2 years is a strategy of folly, and thoughtless folly at that. I give way to the member.
Would the member agree that protection of free movement on this island is of paramount importance, not just for the 30,000 people who cross it every day, but for businesses trading in Ireland?
And that's why thank you, Mr. Speaker. That's why the Irish government should convene a forum for the future, in order to recognise that those, as Mark Durkin again said, who tailgate London as the road to the future will realise that they've been left behind down that road in some other place. Because every time we rely upon London, especially when it comes to money, in every negotiation with Blair or Brown or Cameron and Villiers, they have come up short. How much shorter will they be? I will give way in a second. How much shorter will they be in this negotiation, given the trauma and the fallout of what has happened? And secondly, can I ask the Deputy First Minister, how are we going to deal with the immediate consequences of what is going to happen? Higher inflation. This is the next 2 years. This is not even beyond 2 years.
Ask the
higher
member
inflation,
to conclude his remarks.
Revised economic forecast down. Fiscal surplus by 2019-20 out the window. Corporation tax in jeopardy. Firms being denied market access and investment deferred. How in real time, in the real lives of people, how are we going to deal with all of that?
Health is without question one of the areas which will be most negatively affected by the United Kingdom's departure from the European Union. That is why it is so outrageous that the Leave campaign used the notion of redirecting £50 million per day from EU contributions to the NHS, when it was clear that they had neither the intention nor the power to make this happen. Northern Ireland, even on the Leave campaign's own figures, is a net beneficiary from the EU. And the economic damage already apparent in the withdrawal investments, especially even this morning, demonstrates that this supposed extra money simply does not exist. I'll go away in a minute. Even at UK level, in any case. Yet many of the people who voted to leave last Thursday will have listened to this pledge and, more importantly, believed it. It will have informed their choice. Many of them will be very vulnerable, very reliant on the health and social care sector, and will now be feeling very deceived by the political class who frankly should have known better. It is well documented that the most marginalised communities across the United Kingdom will be those most reliant on an effective and responsive health and social care sector. People living with or caring for people with a long-term condition were led to believe that Brexit was an opportunity to invest in local services, to provide more appointments for with GPs and to speed up surgical procedures. For as we all know in this House, Mr Speaker, all politics is local, and some people will have naturally seen the referendum through this prism of being reliant on a well-resourced health sector. Already, prominent Leave campaigners have now admitted that this is simply not so. The reality of leaving the EU, particularly if we are forced out of the single market, is that this will have very significant impact on medical advancement in terms of the end of EU-funded, EU-wide medical research projects, where academics and medical researchers are sharing knowledge and resources to contribute to the advancement of less intrusive screening and quicker diagnosis, and the discovery of treatments and medical equipment that improve the prognosis for patients. We will now be outside these processes, and it will cost us dearly, not just in terms of financial costs, but in human costs, to avail of this research for local application. Turning now to our nearest EU partner, we have seen, thankfully, over the last few years, the emergence of mature political cooperation on the island of Ireland, and nowhere more so than in healthcare. There are now high-profile cross-border arrangements in terms of, for example, children's cardiac surgery procedures, of which 25 children from Northern Ireland have benefited from since 2014, and the cross-border healthcare directive, a EU directive, which allows people to avail of services and programmes in other EU countries if they're not available in their own country. For example, the Smarmore Castle Private Clinic, which has helped many individuals in Northern Ireland avail of residential treatment for drug and alcohol addiction, which is not available here. This is just a few examples. And now, most recently, the very high-profile expert panel, which is led by Professor Bengoa, he told us, and I suppose he told all the parties, that he is holding meetings with the Health Department in the Republic of Ireland to see where we can both look at allowing all Ireland reform for our neighbouring health and social care sectors. We've both got finite resources because we both see that strong cross-community cooperation is vital. The question now for the Executive is, what is the contingency plan to ensure this cross-border cooperation can continue, to ensure Northern Ireland's health and social care sector can access the latest medical research and avoid being forced to withdraw from a single market against the will of the majority of people in Northern Ireland? I would emphasise to the House that it would be the height of irresponsibility if the Executive has no such plan in place. Thank you.
Paul, Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I went to bed around midnight on Thursday night, listening to Nigel Farage effectively sort of give up the ghost and accept that the vote was going against him. I woke up at 4 a.m. to see Nigel Farage on the TV again making his victory speech, and I have to say it's been one of the most sickening experiences since I've got involved and got interested in politics. That's a very emotional response. It's not what's important. But I think it actually does speak to a lot of this campaign. It has been emotional. It has been emotive. And I think as well it has certainly put together strange bedfellows. The Leave campaign consisting of it was, on the one hand, the far right, on the other hand, the far left, united in a campaign to leave the EU. And already we've seen the numerous claims tumble. The £350 million a week they were supposed to save by leaving the EU. That was a blatant lie. And those in the Leave campaign admitted now that that was the case. They said that we could spend that money on the NHS. And they were clever in their choice of words. They said could, not will. But it was a clear and intentional deception. In one second, I will. And then they talked of control of our borders, of this idea of a fortress UK, and at the same time told us here in Northern Ireland we didn't need to worry about border controls. I'll give way to the member.
I thank the member for giving way, and particularly on his point about choice of words. Would he agree with me that it went beyond careful choice of words when it said on the poster, let's spend it on the NHS? Not we might or we could, but let's spend it on the NHS. And that's quite a serious thing to do in an election campaign, in a referendum campaign, to blatantly lie about how the money will be spent.
I thank the member for her
intervention, and I completely agree with her that it was a deception. And when we have such a close result, there are questions to be asked about how much people still today already stand over the vote to leave. And it's clear in Northern Ireland we did not vote to leave. And I think we do have a challenge that presents a challenge to our First Minister, because whilst the Prime Minister has announced his resignation because he did not get the vote he campaigned for, it's clear that our First Minister did not get the vote that she campaigned for. And going forward, we need to ask the question, will the First Minister represent the people in Northern Ireland? We are going to have negotiations. I've given way, my time's running out. We are going to have negotiations about how this will affect Northern Ireland. And will she represent the 56% in Northern Ireland who voted to remain? Will she ensure that her colleagues in the Leave campaign meet their commitments, and there will be more spending in public services in Northern Ireland as a result, that there won't be stricter controls on border, on the Irish border? One of the startling things for me in terms of the response was the number of people who've said to me sentiments along the lines of, I went to bed on Thursday as a constitutional unionist. I woke up on Friday as a nationalist. I think the degree of instability this vote has thrown up, and members may laugh, and it is shocking. It is shocking that people are saying that. But it's what I am hearing, and we've seen the evidence, and we've seen Ian Paisley MP talk about coming to him for an Irish passport. I've certainly seen people come to me for Irish passports, and that in itself it may be a practical measure rather than an emotional one, but I think it is part of the indication of the instability. I've said I will not give way at this point that this vote has thrown up. We do need to act with clear calm and caution. We are going to have a new Prime Minister. There's a possibility we could have a new general election. But we do need our First Minister acting on our behalf. What we don't need is a First Minister for unionism. What we don't need, a First Minister who puts first being leader of the DUP. What we need is a First Minister who's going to represent the people of Northern Ireland who've said they wish to remain, and that she will take that argument in the negotiations going forward and the days, weeks, months, and indeed possibly years that are ahead of us.
Call Mr. Raymond McCann.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Let me deal first with the nonsense that was talked earlier today in this chamber about people on the left who had advised a vote to leave. But such people must be in alignment that have been supporting Boris Johnson, Nigel Farage and the rest of that crew across the water. It's absolutely untrue. People Before Profit is quite able to articulate its own particular position, which is different from that of a Boris Johnson, and which is also different from that of the leadership of the Remain side. I was active some years ago in the referendum in the South. Yes, I will.
The member for giving way has said that he can articulate a position that is different to Boris Johnson. Can he deliver it?
I will articulate it now and explain how we propose to deliver it. And if you had waited a few minutes, you wouldn't have had to jump to your feet and ask a question. I fully intended to do that. Yes, I will. It's an obvious question and it's in my mind too.
Member has an extra minute.
Sorry?
The member has an extra minute.
Thank you very much. Great. That's great. First, People Before Profit is always rejected. I've always rejected the European Union. We reject it now because we reject the rottenness that the EU represents. If you want to know the true nature of the EU, look back a year. Just look back a year. We've heard an awful lot about the fact of leaving the EU will threaten sort of spending on community projects, will destroy jobs, will destroy wages and all the rest of it, infrastructure. Will it indeed? Well, if you're worried about that, then referenda. Look back to what the EU did to Greece. When the Greek people in a referendum voted to reject the austerity policies of the European Union. Yes, indeed.
Does the member acknowledge that the people of Greece, with respect to the governance in Greece, made very poor domestic decisions? And does the member acknowledge that the ratepayers and the taxpayers across Europe had entitlement to not keep paying bailout money?
Well, so much for the lady's commitment to democracy. Do I agree that the Greek people had voted in a stupid way? That's what she's asking. It doesn't matter. That's the way she voted. That's the way the people of the cradle of democracy voted. That was the clear implication of your question. Of course it was. They rejected it. The EU rejected that referendum result precisely because they wanted to impose austerity, that they wanted the Greek government to cut social spending, that they wanted a funding withdrawn from all sorts of communities and progressive, no thanks, groups. In other words, they wanted to do all the things which some people in this House are now claiming we couldn't do if we left the EU. Their argument, they should consider the words of Walter Scott, oh, what a tangled web we weave when first we practice to deceive. And they were deceiving. Right? So were the Remain camp and the Out camp across the border. Sorry, yes, go ahead.
The member suggests to us that the European Union was a tangle and a web to deceive. Was it deceiving when it gave women rights? Was it deceiving whenever it gave us environmental rights? Was it deceiving when it gave us employment rights? Was it deceiving whenever it saved refugees? No, it did not.
He's a start at the end, Mr. Speaker. The EU saving refugees, they have erected barbed wire barricades around Fortress Europe. Somebody referred to Fortress UK and immigrants. The main fortress being erected in Europe is in the European Union. Not only do we have barbed wire fences around the edges of it, we have barbed wire fences to stop the movement of people who don't qualify. Within it, around the borders of Hungary, around in Serbia, in Slovenia, you see barbed wire fences within. This is not an organisation which is pulling people together in a benign way. It is dividing people. It is racist. Driving the agreement made between the EU and Turkey, you take one back and we'll send one over. That treating human beings like commodities to be swapped in a barter market. What a disgusting and disgraceful thing to do. Why is it that not a mention of that has been made? And people here talk about the EU and give the impression that it's a benign organisation which has got the interests of ordinary people in this country or anywhere else at heart. They're out talking, rightly so, about the need to go to Dublin and talk to the Dublin government. Anybody remember what happened in the south of Ireland when the EU disapproved? The European Commission disapproved of what the elected Irish government was doing. They were told by the European Commission, do what you're told, or, the quote was, a bomb will go off in Dublin. That's what they were told. Not an explosive device, presumably, but a financial and economic bomb threatened them. Now so many people in Dublin are praising the EU. They're suffering from Stockholm Syndrome. You know, there were times over the last few days watching the football, and I thought I was transferring my allegiance from one day to another from the occupied six counties to the occupied 26 counties. 100 years after 1916, national independence, how are you? The European Union won't stand for national independence in any sense at all. This is an oppressive. Who are they answerable to? They're certainly not answerable. Who are the Commission answerable to? Does anybody here know? Who are the European Commission? I'll tell you who they're answerable to. They're answerable to the bankers, and that's in whose interest they have operated throughout the period of austerity. They're answerable to the more belligerent sections of the European bourgeoisie. They are not answerable to anybody else. Nobody elected them. Of course, you know the British Commissioner resigned on Friday. Anybody know who he was? Anybody know? Lord Hill. Lord Hill was the man. How many people are aware of Lord Hill?
I ask the member to conclude his remarks.
Sorry?
Conclude your remarks.
Yes, you did give me that extra minute, you know. What I say is this. I land with this on the question sort of Scotland and Northern
Call America. Mr. Jim Allister.
Okay.
Mr. Allister.
Okay, I leave it, but I have more to say in some other place.
Mr. Allister has up to 4 minutes, including interventions.
What a broad and appealing church the Leave campaign was. Mr. Speaker, the 23rd of June 2016 will go down in our wonderful history as the day that the people of the United Kingdom shook off the shackles of the decomposing EU and began its rebirth as an independent nation, outward looking to the rest of the world, taking our trade to where the growth is, despite deciding to spend our own money on our own people and deciding to control our own borders. The 23rd of June was the day when this country turned itself around to face in the right direction. And it is sad today that the bad losers of the Remain campaign couldn't face the future. All they could do was refight the battle they've lost and try to tear down our country even more in the doing of that. But the worst point of that came from the leader of the SDLP, a party that lectures us all in the purity of their commitment to democracy, but told us today he doesn't accept the result. The result is emphatically clear. The question was emphatically clear. It was, not does Northern Ireland want to stay in Europe? The question was, does the United Kingdom? And yes, it's interesting to know how the component parts of the United Kingdom might have thought about that question. But it's not the definitive outcome. The definitive and autonomous vote was the vote of the entire United Kingdom. And it is that which those who refuse to accept the outcome of this referendum are rejecting. The sovereignty of the people of the United Kingdom. And they cling in their little minds to some little part of the United Kingdom. Some never were so attached to the entity of Northern Ireland, never so respectful of the views of the people of Northern Ireland. But it's the people of the United Kingdom that have made this decision. We joined the United Kingdom as one nation. We joined the EU as one nation, and we leave the EU as one nation. And that's how it can and must be. Much challenge to the First Minister. Yes, the First Minister has things to do, but among them are identifying the opportunities. We now need to see a programme across the departments identifying which regulations which were put upon us by the dead hand of Brussels in imposing their directives can now safely and properly and swiftly, once we leave, be repealed. There needs to be a programme to identify that. There needs to be a programme to identify how we're going to cope with new powers. Isn't it ironic that some who come to this House week in and week out bleating for more powers for this House are now amazed and disturbed that in consequence of leaving the EU, we've got more powers to the devolved assembly. We've got powers over fishing. We've got powers over agriculture. We've got powers
ask the Member to conclude his remarks.
The First Minister has a job to do, and it is to identify how we're going to exercise those powers and how we're going to make a bonfire of hideous regulation.
Calling the First Minister to respond to the debate, and the First Minister has up to 30 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I don't think I will need those 30 minutes. I make this response this afternoon. I respond to the debate on behalf of the Executive, and this has been agreed with the Deputy First Minister. And following the outcome of the referendum, the Deputy First Minister and I will act to represent the best interest of Northern Ireland. Until such times as any new arrangements are negotiated and take effect, we want to make it clear that business continues as usual and the flow of goods and services and normal travel arrangements remain in place. We do want to assure citizens from other European Union countries living here that we value and recognise the contribution that they make to our society. I've already indicated that in response to Mr. Maskey when he asked me a question today, but it's important to underline that point. And the priority of the Executive will be to ensure Northern Ireland's interests are protected and advanced, and that new opportunities are developed as part of any new arrangements within the United Kingdom and the Republic of Ireland, as well as with our other European neighbours. We will seek to work with executive colleagues to plan for the new realities and to maximise the benefits for Northern Ireland of this changed situation. Mr. Speaker, the Deputy First Minister and I were elected with a huge mandate to work for our people, and we remain determined to do so. We have a window of opportunity in the coming months in order to ensure that we do all we can to deliver the best possible outcome for all of our people. We have both already spoken to the Prime Minister and the Secretary of State for Northern Ireland. The Deputy First Minister and I have also requested an urgent meeting with the Prime Minister in the coming weeks to discuss matters further. We will meet with the Irish Prime Minister, Enda Kenny, next Monday to commence discussions on the nature of our relationship going forward. Executive Ministers have been in contact with each other throughout the weekend and over the course of today, and a full meeting of the Executive will take place on Wednesday, which the main discussion point will be how we deliver the best possible outcomes for Northern Ireland. Sir Malcolm McKibben, as head of the civil service, has also held formal discussions with his UK counterpart this afternoon, and we have asked the head of the civil service to establish individual departmental teams at senior level and to put in place an overarching central administrative and political governance structure, as well as formal east-west, north-south and EU liaison teams that will report directly to myself and the Deputy First Minister. Each executive department will establish a senior team to consider the potential implication for their departmental functions, legislations and regulations, as well as identifying future challenges and opportunities. These teams will liaise with Whitehall, the Irish and EU counterparts, to ensure that we get the best possible deal that we can for Northern Ireland. For our part, as leaders of the executive, we are agreed and determined that our specific circumstances in Northern Ireland must be accounted for in any new arrangements that are developed. The Chief Executive of Invest Northern Ireland is this week in the United States and will establish a liaison group with the business community in Northern Ireland. In terms of foreign direct investment, we almost exclusively target cost centre opportunities, as we do not yet have a tax profit advantage, something that we hope to have in the future. Cost centres are mainly offshore services centres for their parent operations, and the majority of them are United States of America or GB-based, so market access is not an issue for them. You will know that our proposition majors on two key factors, talent and cost, and those have not changed. And we expect to continue to drive forward on foreign direct investment. If you consider the list of FDI successes over this past 5 years, Allstate, Concentrix, Alexander Mann, Deloitte, PwC, EY, CME, White Hat, Capita, Kenya, Baker McKenzie, Allen & Overy, Herbert Smith Freehills, Concentrix, and Teleperformance, to name but a few, they are all servicing either the United States of America or the United Kingdom. Sir Malcolm McKibben will also travel to Brussels later this week to meet with our members of the European Parliament, British, Irish and European Union representatives, as well as meeting with senior Whitehall representation next week in London. Representatives from our three international offices in Brussels, Washington and Beijing will consider implications from their perspectives and provide briefings to us shortly. Mr. Speaker, we are determined to use our influence to build for the future, provide stable leadership at home, and reassure those concerned that Northern Ireland will continue to be an excellent place to do business. The coming weeks and months will, I have no doubt, present many challenges, both to the Deputy First Minister and myself, but we have both made it clear that whatever the outcome of the referendum, that we would work to do what was right for the people of Northern Ireland. We said that before the referendum. We told the committee that that would be our position, so our position has not changed. We will continue to work for all of the citizens of Northern Ireland, and that is our clear mandate.
I call Mr. David Ford to wind up on the debate.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. We are currently facing the biggest crisis in the United Kingdom since at least 1945. It's a political crisis, at least as far as affects the two largest parties in Westminster. It's an economic crisis, it's a financial crisis, it's an institutional crisis, and it's a constitutional crisis. It affects every part of the UK, the decision that was taken last Thursday, and yet there are specific issues for Scotland and Northern Ireland which do need to be addressed in a separate and distinctive way. The issue which is highlighted, for example, just now by Mr. Allister about the question of repealing European legislation is an issue which may well come to this House. And Mr Alistair and his friends, well, his current friends on the DUP benches, may find that they have difficulty getting a majority to repeal some aspects of European legislation which some of us would support. So it's not half as simple or half as simplistic as has been presented by some speaking in this debate. In opening the debate, Mr Nesbitt highlighted a few key points. I'll give way later. He talked around the issue of corporation tax, and there is a fundamental issue on the basis of what has just been said by Mrs Foster about skills and costs, whether we could now afford corporation tax if we are not to get the benefit of having the wider EU market to companies based here. Mr Nesbitt also talked about issues like funding for the European Union, of which there was very little talk from those in favour of leave. He referred to the potential consequences for the Barnett formula, with a potential change of track by the government. He referred to the issue of the common travel area, a very significant issue for those of us who live in Northern Ireland, especially those of us who live close to the border. Key issues on which we await answers. We await answers from those who led leave nationally, and we await answers from those who led leave locally. Mr Eastwood and Mr Murphy then continued and talked about some of the benefits we have. The peace programme, Interreg, European Social Fund, key issues which need to be addressed and which haven't been properly covered. And certainly it was the case that we had some lectures from the DUP about democracy and accepting the will of the people expressed in that referendum. Well, I just so wish that members of the DUP had accepted the views of a somewhat larger majority of the people of Northern Ireland in the referendum on the Good Friday Agreement, or perhaps an appropriate majority in Belfast City Hall on how often the Union flag should fly on that building. Decisions which they took, which led to mayhem on the streets and costs of millions of pounds to this community. So let's be clear, if we're talking about accepting democracy, it cuts both ways. Throughout the debate, 60% of those who've been contributing, more or less all of this corner except perhaps Mr McCann and Mr Alistair, have talked about the need for stability and certainty as we go into a very difficult future. It's clear that the only bit of economics that we've seen from some people on the Leave campaign is being very, very economical with the truth. It's clear, for example, as was highlighted by Naomi Long, that that reference to let's spend £350 million a week on the NHS was a complete fabrication which they retracted from on Friday of last week. We've now got further backpedalling. It's supposedly an aspiration. Well, it didn't look like an aspiration on the posters and on the bus. I think we've had enough from your side of the House, thank you. We've seen some very specific issues to show the inadequacy of what was said there. We've had an admission that the so-called immediate controls on immigration simply couldn't work if we're seeking to maintain access to the market. And funnily enough, that truth only came out on Friday from some of the Leave campaign. Philip Smith highlighted the issue of the work done by the Governor of the Bank of England to provide stability in the financial markets. But we haven't actually got a quarter of a trillion pounds every week to prop up sterling. And that's the kind of issue which came up. Yet when some of us talked about the dangers to the finances and the dangers to the UK economy, we were accused of scaremongering. We were absolutely right in what we said on that. And those who said scaremongering have been proven to be absolutely wrong. We had today a litany of keep calm messages from the DUP benches. Frankly, Corporal Jones should have been in the chamber. They were delivered with slightly greater calmness than Corporal Jones would have delivered the message, but their value was complete nonsense, because it was clear that the Leave campaign nationally had no plan A for if they won, and the Leave campaign in Northern Ireland has no plan A as to what to do with it. We've had hopes and wishes and aspirations from the DUP benches. We have had nothing of substance. And certainly I'd prefer to go on the basis of what the Governor of the Bank of England says about the future of the UK economy than the kind of pious aspirations which have been expressed by those who wish to leave. We've also had patronising references to little people coming from the DUP benches. We on the Remain side didn't talk like that, but that's the way they've patronised the people. And I suspect when some of the decent people who believed the stories told by the Leave campaign see what it actually means, they may perhaps change things. Because this wasn't the little people. This was a fight about the future leadership of the Tory party, with all the problems that that involved. But those who would see, if they are wishing to draw a pension in the near future, that they have real difficulties, because of economic uncertainty. They will realise that straight away, just the way as our students, those studying in things like the Erasmus programme across the EU, or hoping to, will see problems. And we had a highlighting of the significant drop in the exchange rate of a pound to, I think it was €1.20, that Mr. Begg said. Steve Aiken talked about the cut in potential foreign direct investment, but in fact we have already seen that. 1,000 financial services jobs have moved from London to Paris. Yeah. And if that's happening from London to Paris, who's to say it's not going to happen from Belfast to Dublin as well? It's not actually a cut in potential future investment. It's a loss of past investment, the kind of companies that the First Minister has just highlighted as successes. How much of a success will they be if those companies relocate into the EU over the next 2, 3 or 4 years? It is simply not correct, Deputy Speaker, to say that we are in a state of business as usual, because business is adapting a whole lot quicker than the politicians who led the Leave campaign. Patsy McGlone highlighted one key issue around the peace process. And that is an important issue, both in terms of the way peace was established between France and Germany, the expansion to Central and Eastern Europe a decade ago, and the support for our own peace process. None of us on our side of the argument talked about World War III, but the Leavers suggested we did and got away with another bit of misinformation. And we also had, in terms of the sort of aspirations that people have, the vision expounded by Eamon McCann. Despite the challenge from Naomi Long, he gave us a wonderful socialist vision, but he didn't tell us anything about putting that vision into practice. Deputy Speaker, I have a little bit of knowledge of recent time of justice issues. And I know that we have major problems now because we will lose the European arrest warrant, and we have no certainty as to how we would reinstate something like that. And the issue of the previous legislation in the Republic has gone and is no longer available to Northern Ireland. Just the casual thing, because that's all about asserting our sovereignty. But if we don't get something like the European arrest warrant back, some people are going to be very sore. Where are we in terms of the cooperation through Eurojust and Europol? Where are we in terms of sharing information about justice? Where are we in terms of asset seizures? All of those are key matters which have been lost by that vote last week, and which the Leavers didn't even think of and have no answer for at this stage at all. So there really are a series of questions which this motion highlights. And let me just put a few of them across the different departments, and I'll do it briefly. The Executive Office really needs to give us a clear statement on the position of citizens from elsewhere in the EU who are now working in Northern Ireland. Just as I said, needs to talk about issues like shared intelligence and the European arrest warrant. The economy needs to talk about how we're going to maintain free movement of labour, particularly those people who cross the border on a regular basis. We need to look at issues like whether we will still get access to R&D funding under Horizon 2020 or student exchanges. Finance really does need to do some detailed work on the impact of a potential reduction in corporation tax. And infrastructure needs to see what's happening to things like the York Street interchange or the A6. Communities will have a massive obligation to make up European funding for voluntary and community groups and housing associations. Agriculture and environment does not know what will happen in terms of the loss of CAP funding. Health, as Paula Bradshaw said, has issues about medical research, cooperation and the massive numbers of workers in health and social care from across the EU. And education needs to provide assurances to those young people who will be hoping to go further at their stage in the future. So there are key issues, massive issues, which need to be addressed, which simply haven't been covered. The challenges are real, and there is no point in people behaving like ostriches. The First Minister and Deputy First Minister have an obligation to represent all of Northern Ireland, including the majority of us who voted for Remain. The UK is now a very divided society. It is up to First Minister and Deputy First Minister to supply a coherent negotiating team for the benefit of all Northern Ireland, and the First Minister must live up to the promises she's made.
Thank you. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.